In sports, just like life, you never know when shit happens. But when it does, you could take it like a champ. Why? Because now there's banking that comes with a safety net from Moneyline. Moneyline is an award-winning digital banking app that offers interest-free cash advances and the ability to build up a rainy day fund with roundups into your Moneyline investment account. Now you can prepare for life's surprises. Moneyline. Bank, borrow, invest, and grow all in one app. Go to the App Store and download today.
On today's Part of My Take, we have a Friday twofer for the people. We have our good friend Ryan Russillo. Hilarious interview as always. Always great to catch up with him. We got to do it more. We got to do. I went away from it being like, hey, we should do this more often. So
we don't do it enough.
Yeah, we don't
see each other enough.
Andre Drummond as well. One of those interviews that I think he loves us because he did not expect us to ask questions that we asked. But a great interview. We're going to talk NBA Finals. The Stanley Cup stays in Tampa, Euros, and Firefest of the Week. And, of course, we have guest producers Jake and Youngstown Bob and PMT Memes in the house. So they'll contribute to Firefest as well. Before we get to all of that, Chevy Silverado, the strongest, most advanced Silverado ever. It is the strongest, most advanced Silverado ever. It's strong, advanced, dependable, hardworking. The design is big, bold, and commanding, and the truck turns heads. Whether you need it for tailgating, hauling, towing, boats, there's nothing better than towing a boat to the lake for the weekend in the summer, off-roading, moving day, helping out your friends or family members, or just road trips because it's a great road trip car, truck. Check it out, the Chevy Silverado, and we're still running our deal. If you whisper in the ears of one of the Chevy Silverado salespeople, PMT or Take, you get $100 off your Chevy Silverado and a full tank of gas and a cup of coffee. And none of this is actually real, but try it. Just try it out. I bet you they'll do it. I bet you they would do it if you're thinking about buying a Chevy Silverado.
I'll put it this way. If they're going to walk away from the sale because they don't want to give you a free tank of gas, you don't want to buy it from that person.
Exactly. So check out the new Chevy Silverado, the strongest, most advanced Silverado ever. Okay, let's go.
It's Pardon My Take, presented by Barstool Sports.
Welcome to Pardon My Take, presented by Chevy Silverado, the strongest, most advanced Silverado ever. Today is Friday, July 9th, and PFT, are we really going to do this thing? Are we really going to do the thing where we start every podcast with Suns and Four?
Suns and Four.
Because we just started the podcast with Suns and Four.
Suns and Four. Hey, Big Cat, do you notice anything different about me?
Your hair's lighter.
Yeah, I use Sunin.
Yeah,
Sunin.
Well,
I do
follow you on all
on social media
yeah. accounts. So I did cheat on this test.
Yeah, Sunin Four. That's why I'm doing it.
To
support the bros in Phoenix.
Oh my God, the bros. We'll get to the bros. I mean, let's just say it right now. There are moments in Phoenix where it just feels like it's Coachella or Burning Man, but it's an NBA Finals game. We both clipped certain fans that like, and then they showed the pregame. The guy, what was his name?
Dallin Husso.
Yeah, Dallin Husso. You make that up. Like, I don't know.
That is the name of the Burning Man.
If we did that as a fake name, people would be like, dude, that's too far.
No, Dallin Husso is the ultimate. He's the Suns bro. And you know what? I've noticed also that the Suns fans, they have such an eclectic look amongst them, but they all come together to create like the perfect energy inside that stadium.
Yes.
You'll have one guy wearing like a Suns shirt and a Browns hat, another guy like wearing a Yankees jacket over his Suns jersey with no undershirt. They root for all different teams outside of basketball.
But they're here for the Suns.
But they're here for the Suns. Yes. And when they're an 8K, it hits different. It hits
the
a little bit different
is
in 8K.
Wild.
It's way different than when they're showing like the British fans in 8K. And yeah. The cameraman has a guy that got stabbed earlier that morning, and then a girl that looks like a guy that looks like me,
and then
like six guys with braces to choose from.
Yes.
But yeah, the Suns fans in 8K, it made the viewing experience that much better.
It was incredible. So let's talk about the game. So the Suns, Well, let's start with the Bucks. Giannis was incredible. Giannis deserves more help. Giannis, he deserves more help. He actually just deserves his max players, Chris Middleton, to play like a max player. He had 42. He was doing it all. Like, everything that he wanted to do, and maybe that was the Suns' strategy, like, hey, Giannis will get his, no one else will get theirs, but Giannis was, like, exceptional. It was reminiscent, maybe not to the level, but that finals game, the classic J.R. Smith game, when LeBron had, like, 50, he had, like, a 50-point triple-double in a loss to the Warriors in that game one. Like, this was a Giannis display. He was the best player on the court, and he had no help. Because Chris Middleton and Drew Holiday were combined 12 for 37. And we had this discussion the other day that Paul George gets paid a lot, and he deserves the criticism because he gets paid a lot. Chris Middleton gets paid $33 million a year. Like, Chris Middleton has had moments in these playoffs, but you need him to play better than what he played in the game tonight. 5 for 16 and 1 for 6 from 3. Like, You can't win with that. You cannot win with that when that's your second best guy and a max guy.
And Giannis at the line, to his credit, he was shooting the ball a lot faster tonight. I think he was averaging like 8.5 seconds, 9 yeah. seconds per free throw. And I think he shot, what, 13 to 20?
Yeah, he was so actually not bad.
A decent night by his standards, a very good night by his standards.
11 for 18.
11
so
for 18.
So that's pretty good.
That's really good, yeah, for him. So he can't do it all on his own. His left knee, every time he hits the ground, I get a bad feeling about it because like his body is so freakish that he was able to come back this fast. But you can tell it's not 100%. And that's
kind of crazy.
It's kind of terrifying to yes. think that the stuff that he's doing out there is when he's not 100%. He was doing that thing that we always say that LeBron should do every time he gets the ball, which is just put your head down and drive to the basket.
Yeah.
And he was just running people over left and right. It was such like violent encounters at the rim that there were like three times that somebody just got knocked on their ass as he was going up for a layup or a dunk, and the refs didn't even do the thing where they blow the whistle and make a call one way or the other.
Yeah.
They're just like, that's a fair play. That's good, clean defense. Giannis is just that much stronger.
He's that much stronger. And then the Suns, so everything I just said about the Bucks, the opposite for the Suns, because the Suns, that was a complete team game. All five starters in double digits. It felt like they all had their moments. Like, Mikal Bridges, well, Jay Crowder comes out, he's hot the first, he hits his first like few shots. Mikal Bridges carried them in the first half. Then Devin Booker goes absolutely insane. Like, everyone chipped in. Everyone played well. Devin, every single time the Bucks felt like they were making a run. Every time they got it to 5 or 6. And it was a game, pretty much the entire game, because they would come back. The Suns would just hit a huge shot in their face. And obviously, everyone will show that one possession, which was phenomenal, where everyone on the team touched the ball. And it was like kind of a scramble drill. And it was just like, that's a team that is playing cohesive basketball and everyone knows their role and they all fit perfectly. And you can't beat that with one guy. And I feel bad for Giannis. He was trying to get us free tacos. Free tacos if the Bucks won tonight.
You can't just tease us with free tacos, bringing back the Doritos Loco, the fire taco, right?
Yep.
You can't just tease us with that and then not give it to us. Come on, Taco Bell.
Yeah.
Like, we watched the game. We tried to support you. I did love that possession, though. The possession.
It was incredible.
It was don't shoot until everybody touches the ball. It was, that's a possession that, like, your dad will email to you in a week
mm-hmm.
when he sees the video online. Be like, hey, remember when I used to coach your team back when you were 8 years old? This is what I preach. Fundamentals.
Devin Booker following his shot. He followed his shot all night long.
Yep. I would like to see the statistical breakdown of Jay Crowder's performance as it relates to how likely the Suns are to win. Like, if he shoots over 50% from three, because he's not afraid to shoot.
No.
If he shoots over 50% from three, how often do they win the game? Because I would imagine that's the tipping point. See, Malcolm Gladwell, fuck you, I can be smart too.
Mm-hmm.
That's the tipping point for the Suns' offense, because you have a chance at beating them if the role players don't contribute like that. But if they do, you have no chance.
Yeah, and like I said, Mikal Bridges is like, he in the first half, he carried him. He ended up with 27. Also, shout out our guy Frank Kaminsky. Yep. He had a trillion again.
Mm-hmm.
But let's just point out, not only did he had a trillion, so he had 1 minute, no stats, but he was a plus two in the plus minus.
Oh, wow, huge.
So how about that?
Yeah, and you know what? No turnovers.
No turnover.
A clean game from Kaminsky again.
Yeah, and he logged minutes.
Wait, is he playing a perfect final so far?
Yeah, he is.
Keep your eyes peeled on that.
He's a plus two overall.
Yeah, but he's got a perfect stat line.
Correct.
Going zero turnovers. he could be one of the first people to ever do that.
Let's get it done. I think Giannis scored like 20 points in the third quarter. That was insane. I do feel bad for Pat Connaughton. I said that out loud while we were watching, because the Bucks bench is short and they just don't, they don't have enough guys, especially when their guys aren't playing. And he's out there. He's trying his fucking best. And there's still moments where it's like, oh, he probably shouldn't be in an NBA. He probably shouldn't be playing 34 minutes in an NBA Finals. But he's out there trying.
I keep thinking that he's Dante DiVincenzo.
Yeah, who's out for the season.
Out for the season, yeah. That's,
yeah, that hurts.
I think that this could be a different story if Dante was in there.
Yeah. Is he actually still on the Bucks?
He is,
I think he is.
Yeah, he just, what is his ankle?
I don't know.
Broken
something,
ankle?
Something. I love that guy, though. DiVincenzo. I'm going to look it right now.
I will say something good about Bugs.
Are you looking it up?
Because
no. Oh yeah, he's still in the Bucks.
We like to have some fun with Buds on this show.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he got out coached as badly as he did in Game One tonight.
No, I'm not going to pick on the halftime show, but Jay Williams did happen to say that the Bucks weren't making any adjustments. They made like a million adjustments in the first half. They were trying everything defensively to stop them, and so I agree with you. Like It just simply comes down to the fact that you can't have your second and third best player no show a finals game. Mm-hmm. Like, Giannis did more than enough that if Chris Middleton and Drew Holiday just make like three or four more shots each, it's a different game. And it sucks because you waste a performance like that from Giannis. But man, like, you can't have those guys no show like that.
Well, I just updated the box score here. They took an assist away from Chris Paul. So he was at 9 at the end of the game. They brought him down to 8. Can you imagine if the PMT Suns and Forbet had hit at 10?
Ooh.
And then they took one away after the fact?
No, I couldn't.
So it's a blessing. So it's a blessing that he didn't get to 10.
Also, I just love this series because it's 2-0 on the over. And it was a life too short to bet the under day because that second quarter was terrible. And then they just, that's the NBA, baby. What I think the Suns ended up taking, I think they went like 20 for 40 from three. That's pretty, 20 for 40 from three. That's actually, look, we're a Suns podcast. We think it's Suns in four. But I actually think that stat, 20 for 40 from three, is even more on the side of Giannis is so incredible. That the team went 20 for 40 from three and only won by 10 points. Giannis kept them that much in the game when they were shooting that well.
They shot 48.9% from two.
Yeah, they were on
and
fire.
And then 50%
from
three.
They're a really fucking good team. Like, the Suns are just a really, really good team. And they're a team, back to that possession, they just play like everyone knows their role and all the pieces fit so well together.
Mm-hmm.
Where, like, you just see it. You see it. Like, they have every single thing they need. And Chris Paul at the helm. I don't know. Suns and four. Although, I do think the Bucks. I think the Bucks will win.
I want it to be Suns and four because, as we've said, Suns and four is just a lot of fun to say.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fun. You know what? It's not really a saying. It's more of just a mentality.
Yeah.
It's more of like the Suns could win this series in a gentleman's sweep. And that's still Suns and four. They still won four games.
Yeah.
It's just all about – sometimes it's about the journey, not the destination, man. But I'm looking at campaign stats here. Do you remember tonight when Mark Jackson was like, the offense should run through campaign right now?
Well, I think it was the moment when campaign – there was like – it was a one-on-four, Cam being the one,
mm-hmm.
and he shot a three-pointer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's just the respect a campaign gets.
And his three-point shot is – it's ugly. But it works sometimes.
Champagne campaign? Is that what they said?
Campaign has moments where he really does, like, for stretches of a game. It was probably a 3 or 4 minute stretch tonight where he does think that he's Kobe Bryant.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he thinks that, like, listen, everyone get out of my way. I'm not passing the ball. It's my game.
Mamba mentality.
Yeah,
you got to have it.
It's Mamba mentality with not the Mamba skill set.
Is there anything worse than having maybe the worst player in team? I'm not saying this about campaign, but I'm just saying
better, like, not.
About another team that has like the last guy off their bench with the Mamba mentality. First, you have to have the Mamba physicality get to the Mamba mentality.
See, I like the Mamba. Like,
what comes first?
If you're a role player, if you're a bench guy, having the Mamba mentality is not always a bad thing because you want a guy coming off the bench who's like, hey, he could catch fire. He could, like, he could do some things, like pushing it a little bit. So I like what campaign does.
I'll put it this way. What if Billy Football had Mamba mentality?
That would be a problem.
On this show,
that would be a problem. That would be a big problem.
Because Jake, the guy sits next to, actually is Mamba mentality.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Jake's more like Tim Duncan. That's just silently like incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Silently the GOAT. All right, so Suns, I do think the Bucks are going to win on Sunday night. It is now the Suns are going to win this series. I'll just say it. I think you agree.
Yeah, Suns are going to win. I'm actually going to revise. I think it's going to be a gentleman's sweep. I'm rooting for Suns in actual four, but I think it's going to be 4-1.
I do think, though, that Giannis is going to have a legacy resurgence in a loss in this series. Because in the Brooklyn series, everyone's like, Giannis, like, limited player. Well, no, he was going up against Kevin Durant, who, you know, however you want to argue it, one or two best players in the NBA. He's not as good as him, but he still is really, really fucking good and a superstar in every facet of the game.
I've always heard that role players play better at home.
Yeah.
I don't know how true that is. It sounds like it's a really good thing to say and a smart thing to say. So that's what I'm believing is going to happen in games 3 and 4. So they'll get some contributions from, like, Middleton. Obviously, he's not a role player, but
and
Lopez.
And Dano Beers.
And Dana Beers. I was asking, is Dana going to be up there?
I think so. I assume so. He's got an invite from Bakhtiari.
Yeah, he's
got
to go.
So he is the definition of a role player who will play better at home.
He is a Suns fan in a Milwaukee body.
Yeah.
That's the perfect description of Dana Beers.
Yes, that is. All right, let's talk some other sports. The Stanley Cup is staying in Tampa Bay. Tom Brady, the town that Tom Brady lives in, those stats are just continue to be ridiculous. I think we went over it, like, every Bay Area team when he was growing up won. When he went to Michigan, like, the Red Wings and then Michigan football, then the Red Sox, the Celtics, everyone won in Boston. Now in Tampa, you have three titles in less than 12 months.
And you've got a World Series that was barely lost by the Rays.
Yep. So Tampa was just incredible. I have the one thing that's nuts to think about. Obviously everyone goes to the UVA losing to UMBC, coming back and winning it all the next year, right? That is the ultimate redemption tour. I think the Tampa Bay Lightnings might be right behind that because the famous tweet, I'll read it for everyone. This was after they got swept by the Blue Jackets in round one. The Tampa Bay Lightning main account tweeted, "We don't have any words and we know you don't want to hear them. We understand your anger, your frustration, your sadness. Everything you're feeling, we get it. This isn't the ending we imagined and certainly not the one we wanted. Thank you for being there the entire way."
Mm-hmm.
And then they went and won back-to-back Stanley Cups. That's pretty much perfect, right?
With the help of the no-cap lifestyle.
We're
not capologists.
I'm not going to argue it because I know that other teams, Blackhawks might have done it.
Yeah.
So it may be a little different because Patrick Kane got hurt in the middle of the season.
Right, in this one, Kucherov got hurt last year.
Correct.
During that season.
Correct.
And then they used like a special exemption this year. But you know what? If you're playing by the rules they give you, can't really complain about that.
And you know what?
It's absolutely 100% something that Belichick would do.
And also Andre Vasilevsky, I probably butchered his name. He was incredible. The stat that I saw last night, he is now in 5 straight series, closeout games, had a shutout.
But wait, what about game 4? Because they didn't win game 4.
No. In 5 straight closeout games.
Yeah.
So, no, in 5 straight series, the closeout game.
The game that they ended up winning, not the one that
they had potential.
The last
game of the series, he has had a shutout.
Yeah.
5 straight.
I was a little bit confused about that because I was thinking back and I was like, wait, I thought they were talking about clinching games.
No, so he pitched a shutout in the Stanley Cup final last year against Dallas. Then every game that they won the series this year was a shutout.
Yeah, he's a maniac.
That's incredible.
Me and Fights were talking about as we watched the game together that if his name was just like a little bit shorter,
mm-hmm.
he would be a household name.
Yeah.
I mean, but Vasilevsky, it's just like, what if it was Vilevsky?
Yeah.
Everybody would be like, yo, that's Valley. He's
or just
incredible.
Ski.
Or just Ski.
Vesky.
Vesky, yeah. Vesky. He needs a sweet nickname. Like Van Beesbrook, that's a long last name, but the Beezer.
Yeah. The skier.
The skier, Vesky.
Yeah.
Vesky actually works. Vesky plays.
Andre Vesky?
And I'm going to do something I never thought that I'd do. I want to take my hat off to the Tampa Bay Lightning fans.
Not third leg Greg,
but the rest of them. And not the people that sat around me and hit Nate in the face.
No, Nate deserved it.
Nate deserved it.
Nate would admit that he deserved
Nate
it.
Nate deserved it. But they seem like a decent group of fans.
Yeah.
And I think they have the longest sellout streak in the NHL? That seemed to me like that's just us thinking, oh, they're a Florida team. They can't be that good of hockey fans. But apparently Tampa Bay Lightning fans are actually, like, very dedicated.
No, I mean, my time in Tampa Bay has only been during the Stanley Cup playoffs. So I don't know what a regular season game. I'm sure it's just as good. But it is an electric, like, environment. Everyone is locked in. I also would like to add the fan that followed me into the bathroom in 2015 and said he was going to beat my ass while I was wearing full pads, pissing at the urinal, and I could not defend myself because he could have just grabbed me by the back of the jersey.
Sweated you while you're
fucked.
Pissing?
I would have been fucked.
Sweated with your dick out?
Yeah, he does not get included in the great fans.
There was one guy that was sitting right in front of me, and he threatened to have me kicked out because I was a Caps fan. And then he was like, you probably didn't even pay for these tickets. You probably can't even afford them. What is it that you do? And I was like, I own a professional basketball team in New Zealand. And then he just looked at me and I was like, do you own a professional basketball team? And his wife was staring at him now and he goes, yes. Just like completely no. Lying about it, but yeah. Absolutely not. You can't get big dicked by the guy behind you that looks like Kid Rock with AIDS. So it was that. Besides that guy, I'm taking that guy out.
That guy out too. I don't think we own the Water Dogs at that point, but it's smart to not mention the Water Dogs when someone says something, because then they would have the one up.
He would have been like, okay, yeah, at least I don't own that team.
Yeah, like that's the worst. That's not something to brag about.
No.
Shout out the Water Dogs. We had two guys on the reserve, all-star reserves. I don't know how that works.
A lot of the superstars don't like to play in the all-star game because
it's like that DeGrom. Load management.
Yeah.
Who's our DeGrom?
Yeah.
Drew Snyder.
Drew Snyder's he's our DeGrom.
He needs an enforcer.
The guys don't want to do the skills competition either. It's become like, okay, too risk of injury at this point. So it's almost better that you get on the reserve. Remember Andy Dalton was like a Pro Bowl reserve for like 3 years in a row?
Mitch was in the Pro Bowl.
That's true, yeah.
And everyone did the whole meme because it was Deshaun, Mitch, and Mahomes all on the Pro Bowl.
How long into this season? Let's just say hypothetically Justin Fields lights it up and he comes out of the gate, like, first month.
Why does it have to be hypothetically?
I'm just saying that the first month he throws, like, I don't know, 15, 20 touchdowns or something like that. And then runs for another 10.
Great.
So if he does that, do all the memes about here's what Patrick Mahomes has done compared to the Bears quarterbacks in the time frame leading up to this year, do those go away? Do people just stop making fun of Bears quarterbacks?
No, it's going to take more time. Yeah. It's probably going to take more time.
I don't want to give it up that easy.
No, I mean, Youngstown Bob, you love it because it has shifted. Like, the emergence of Baker and then Mitch, like, the bad quarterbacks has shifted to the Bears.
Yeah, like, I didn't watch the draft this year.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Fuck you. The guy who runs the CBS sports account, like, he hates the Bears.
He's out of
the
job at that
point. No, he every single, like, he basically does, it's Dana Beer doing Beers doing the beer tweet. He's like, oh, I need engagement. Do the Bears tweet.
Uh-huh.
Do the Bears quarterback
tweet. And then half of the engagement is just people tagging you. Yeah. Be like, hey, remember that your quarterbacks all suck?
Yeah, I do. I remember. All right. Sneaky, awesome sports weekend. McGregor on Saturday night. Wimbledon final. Federer. Where's Jake? Oh, Jake's not here. Jake Marsh decided not to show up because his goat, Federer, choked. Is Djokovic still in it?
Yeah, I think he was. As early as yesterday, he was still in it.
Yeah, I don't.
So I haven't followed up on that.
I really.
News travels slowly across the pond.
I'm going to watch at least 10 minutes of the Wimbledon final.
I'm going to have strawberries and cream.
I actually don't know if I'll watch 10 minutes. He is. Who's in it still, memes? Berrettini versus Hurkacz?
I'm going to go.
That's made up.
Wait, who's playing against Djokovic? Okay,
About Sharapova? No, Shapovalova.
I got Joker in four sets.
Four sets. I do too. I have Joker to win the whole thing.
Is anybody going to be watching Wimbledon in England? Is the crowd going to be completely empty there?
It is a lot of there. Yeah, I mean it's like 8 a.m. So no, that's actually a great day. Just go to Wimbledon, get fucked up there on some champagne, then go drink some warm beer and watch. It come home.
I feel like the crowd is just going to be just pounding beers, probably starting at about 10 p.m. the night before.
Yep, absolutely. All right, so should we do, we got a little fantasy lads?
Well, yeah, so, the finals, it's at Wembley Field. We've been saying it's coming home for the last several weeks. So we thought that we'd bring back one of our favorite segments from football season.
Yes.
The Fantasy Lad Boys.
Fantasy Lad Boys. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oi! Oi! It's me, Nigel Garrison. They said we're not coming home. It's coming home, right? It's coming home, isn't it?
It's, what's his name? Cumberbitch. What's his name?
Benedict Cumberbitch.
Benedict Cumberbitch, me and the lads, we're going to head out. We're going to pull a couple Richards and tune some things only, though. We're going to head some beer. I'm just reading KB's tweets with all the slang.
Hey, wait. Bloody blood clot. They said the British would have their heads hung like a chicken. I say some chicken.
My boy's got a free yard, so going to rock up to us with a few fat tinnies, then roll fat Zimmer and be lick off.
Right, innit? Wait. Whoa. What for bloody HE double cricket bats is that?
Who are these boys?
What's up, fuckheads? It's me, Giancarlo Montepulciano Itaggio. My mama is gonna make fucking Sunday sauce out of your rotten teeth, England, you pieces of shit. You think that you can fuck with Italy? My friend, you're gonna meet the Paisans. Some real fellas this weekend.
What's up? It's Tony Rabioli. We're gonna be watching the game down on the Jersey Shore. DJ's in my car. That's all I got.
Hey.
I didn't prepare anything.
It's coming Rome.
It's coming Rome, bitches. We've never even been to Italy. We just fucking love Italy, all right?
I just fucking love...
My great-grandfather's from Sicily, so go fuck off.
I love Sopranos memes.
Chef Boyardee.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, Sunday gravy.
I took a 23andMe test. 0.01% Sicilian, bitch.
Oh, fuck yeah, but you better see my fucking license plate. It got the Italian flag on it.
Hell yeah.
Hey, I'm fucking parking over here.
Yeah. All right.
That's your Euros preview.
That's Fantasy Fuck Boys. So, we've said it's coming home.
Yeah.
I'm record scratch. I'm on Italy this
well,
weekend.
Well, so, we had this discussion beforehand. When you're watching sports that you don't really have a true rooting interest, because, like, I have no English, I have no Italian, like, I don't have a rooting interest, right? I'm rooting then for ultimate tragedy in the most epic way. And there's nothing more tragic than Wembley and the crowd shots that will occur if England finds a way to lose. And after our discussion on Tuesday about how likeable the English fans are, I have to say, kind of left a bad taste in my mouth with that Harry Kane penalty. Like, one, that was not a penalty on Raheem Sterling. Two, I don't think you should be able to rebound a penalty in soccer.
Why not?
I don't know. I just feel like you should get it. If you miss it, you miss it.
All right, I think that what the law should be, they should be more lax on the goalkeepers being allowed to take a step or two off the line.
Yeah.
Or not allow the person to score on their own rebound. You can't make it that tough on the goalie because it was a great save that he made.
Right, it was, and that's
what
I'm saying.
And you can't be expected to hold those types of saves.
Exactly. So I think they need to change the rule. If you miss it, you miss it. It's a fucking free throw. I would hit 9 out of 10 PKs.
Baggio never went after his own rebound.
Mm-hmm.
That's just a fact.
So, yeah, I'm excited for that game, though.
I'm very excited. I think I realized it's a combination of I like the Sopranos memes more than I like the It's Coming Home memes.
Right.
Because it's coming home memes, and it's fun to say until it actually comes home. And then you're like, wait, what do I do with it now?
Yeah.
Now that it's here, I don't have space for it in
right.
my house.
Right.
So I've decided that the Italian memes are way better. Plus, when you have a take on a sport that you don't know that much about and you're being proven correct on it, like my take on Chiesa mm-hmm. being an awesome player, I'm rooting more for my own selfish brain
right.
as a narcissist to believe
right.
that I am a good soccer analyst than I am for British people to be happy.
That was like that Italy-Spain game. When it went to PKs, like Italy was laughing it up, yucking it up. Spain looked like they were so scared for their life. And I was like, Italy's won this just from body language alone.
When you play tiki-taka soccer like the Spaniards do, you look like a coward if you're losing. If you're getting your asses kicked and you just try to do that triangle stuff all the way down the field and you can't get past midfield, you look like a coward.
It is funny that Spain just like they just pass. They forget that you have to shoot. Their shooting button's broken
mm-hmm.
on FIFA.
They're like, you can always get a little bit closer.
Yeah.
There's always a better shot.
Yeah. Keep passing the ball. We'll get there.
Their offense is like the Suns' half-court offense, except they don't have DeAndre Ayton to pass the ball.
Yeah, they need a Harry Kane.
Yeah.
The tap-it-in merchant.
Harry Kane, he's going to look like, what's the other Harry Styles?
Harry Styles.
They're going to make him look like Harry Styles this weekend.
I just love the tap-it-in merchant. It gets everyone so upset.
Also, people are starting to call them Pengland. Because they score too many PKs.
It's true. It is true. All right, let's get to our interviews. We have two great interviews. Ryan Russillo and then Andre Drummond. Great interviews on a Friday, and then we'll finish up with Firefest on the other side. Okay, before we get to our interview with Ryan Russillo, quick word from our friends at Roman. Most guys have tried different ways to last longer, but thinking about baseball doesn't always work. The folks at Roman, an online men's health company, are changing the game with Roman Swipes, the secret to longer-lasting sex. You don't have to count backwards from 10. You don't have to say the Pledge of Allegiance in your head. You don't have to do box scores. You just swipe. Right, Young Sound Bob? You just swipe. He doesn't have his mic on, but he's nodding approvingly. Roman swipes are a clinically proven way to last longer in bed. They're effective, easy to use, and fast-acting, but don't require a prescription. So Roman can ship swipes to you in discreet, unmarked packaging, and each swipes packet is small enough to hide in your wallet for whenever you need it. They're super easy to use. Just take the swipes out of the packet, swipe it on, let it dry. You're good to go. That's it. Go to GetRoman.com/take. You can get your first month of swipes for just $5 when you choose a monthly plan. That's GetRoman.com/take. Okay, here he is, Ryan Russillo. Okay, we now welcome on our very good friend. It's been too long. We wanted to make sure he didn't fall off the top 10 recurring guest list, which I think you might have, but you're back in it. It's Ryan Russillo.
Who's ahead of me?
I think Titus might have leapfrogged you.
That's
fair.
Uh-huh. Dan Heron, maybe. Mr. Portnoy. Yeah, Mr. Portnoy. Ryan Whitney. That's okay, though.
Lenny Dykstra.
You're number one in my heart.
Pro athletes? It's tough. Look, I'm competing with pro athletes all the time. That's fine.
Yeah, number nine in our program, number one in our heart. So, Ryan Russillo, The Ryan Russillo Show, great podcast. Go listen to it right now. But listen to this first. So let's start here, NBA Finals. So you, as you know, we're a huge Suns podcast. We're the number one Suns podcast in the world. Are you rooting for anyone in these finals? Like, you don't actually care about these finals, right?
Right. So obviously you guys are making fun of how much I love Chris Paul. I did a weird video where I said at the end of it, I was like, he's everything you want in a player and maybe even a Sun. And then the people that didn't get it were like, hey, you should have edited that out. Because I say, like, leave it in there. And it was kind of the way to close the whole thing. I would put these finals, like we were talking about it the other day. Like, if you think of all the finals where a team, like it, for me, it'd be the Celtics, right? And then you go, okay, how many finals did I care as much about who won? And a lot of times it's you rooting against somebody. Barkley, Suns, 93 is, I probably care about that one more than the 08 Celtics Lakers. I would put this one probably behind one of the Steph ones, the first Steph one in 2015. But yeah, Chris Paul getting this, if he gets it, this will mean a lot to both Chris's family and mine.
Uh-huh. So let me ask you this. If you were to select one player from each team that you would want your hypothetical non-existent daughter to date, I'm guessing Chris Paul would be the one from the Suns. And then who on the Bucks?
Chris Paul, though, I don't know if I'd want him dating my daughter, because I feel like if he brought her home late, then it'd just be a huge argument. Mm-hmm. He'd be like, no, that's not, there was traffic and you don't understand. And I'd be like, well, which way did you go? And then he'd be like, that's not the way to go. You're wrong. You don't even know the area. And I'd be like, what are you talking about? Like, I've lived here forever. So I think he's very combative and he'd want to win every game and he'd want to win every argument. So that one might be a little tougher to deal with.
I'll throw a name out there.
I got one too.
Aiden? Yeah. Oh,
Aiden?
Aiden.
Baby
okay.
Shaq. Okay. I was going to say.
Wedding in the Bahamas.
Yeah.
Max deal coming up.
He does look older though than like you. Like, Aiton has the old face going. So that
he's
always
got serious, yeah.
It's weird. I don't know. He really does look like he could be 40 and he's 22 or whatever it is.
He also got paid in college, which is, that's a big red flag for
true.
His character.
That's true. Huge
but
red
it's legal
flag.
Now.
That, so yeah, but it wasn't that.
Yeah.
He was a disruptor. No, see, you guys are so behind the times. Now if you do something wrong when it was wrong, everybody's like 15, 20 years later. She's like, what are you talking about? Now you're like, wait a minute. None of the rules apply. Like, if we ever legalize murder, can you imagine OJ's tweets?
He's like, I was a political prisoner.
People forget when you were on the Life episode, you said you got to kill at least once just to see if you like it.
Did I say that?
Yeah, it was a great line. It was a very well-delivered line.
It feels like it's a little out of context now. But yeah, I think I remember something like that. And just try to deliver it deadpan. And it's like, wait a minute. Do you ever want a job again? Maybe you shouldn't do this with people who don't know you.
So Chris Paul. So if... your hypothetical son. So let's say you have a son.
A son, okay.
Let's go 20 years from now. He's playing high school basketball, and
at 20?
No,
he's
no,
still in high school.
Well, I mean, the pregnancy takes at least 10 months. Are you going to get? Let's say in a year you find.
Okay. All right. Right.
You know, the whole thing happens. Not right this second.
That was smart. Okay, yeah, now yeah. I understand the math.
I gave a little
right?
buffer.
I'm like some. Yeah, I'm like, my kid's that dumb.
Yeah. Well, he could be. So, but anyway, so you're chances, like, yeah. you're like, all right, this is my son. He's got everything that Chris Paul has. I love this kid because he's so competitive. And then every other play, he flops. Do you say like, hey, son, I love you so much?
No, my dad used to do this with me after my games. Like if I had a bad game, you know, we'd get in the truck because, you know, we're construction and it had the signs on the side of it, F-150 cherry red. And we'd park. We'd go and park somewhere after I had a bad game. And he'd say, hey, I just want to let you know you decided you were going to have a bad game on the ride over here tonight.
Wow.
Was he right?
Was he right?
It was unbelievable. I mean, he was a big time motivator for me, and he knew he always had to kind of piss me off to really get the best out of me. Like, he's like, you don't play well until you're really mad, and that's when you're at your best. And he's like, if you're not going to be like that, then we're not going to show up to these games anymore, which was ridiculous because we were definitely still showing up to the games. But I would do something like that with Chris Paul, or a version of my son that was just like Chris Paul. And I would be like, look, you know, I'm here for you. Your mother loves you too. You know, we're trying to do the best with the custody arrangement. I'm sorry about the mistakes I've made, but you got to stop flopping.
Yes.
Yeah. We'd have a park, you know, we maybe grab a sub, split a sub in the front cabin of the truck, because that's what my dad and I would do. And yeah, I couldn't, that'd be tough. That'd be really tough. But I don't think he flops the way that other guys flop. And I know everybody's going to push back on that.
Yeah. No, what? No, he's right. He's better at it.
Yeah, he does it more. Yeah. He does it so much that he almost hurts himself. Did you notice? And I know you love Chris Paul. I mean, we are the number one Suns podcast, but you came to the Chris Paul thing like last week. I saw it. We've been on the train for like at least 3 weeks.
Yeah, no, I just started to like him. Yep.
When he got pushed by Pat Beverly, he did kind of flop at the end. He grabbed his face, and then he realized, wait, we're winning this game by 20. I'm good. And he stood up, and he, like, celebrated.
I saw that differently. I got to be honest with you.
This is like Frank Kaminsky. I saw Frank Kaminsky beat the fuck out of Pat Beverly, and everyone else saw something different.
Have you ever been pushed in the back like that, though, when you're not ready? Like, we're lucky. That's like getting rear-ended at 25 miles
an
hour.
It's the thing that they throw people out of, like, pickup games for. If you're driving to the hole and somebody pushes you in your back when you're jumping up in the air, it's actually the most vicious version of assault.
But it hasn't. I've never had it because I'm not a dickhead like Chris Paul.
Here's what I would say about his flopping. I don't like any of it. And the fact that anyone continues to call when the guard is bringing the ball up and he just stops and gets run over by a big guy and they give the guard the foul. Like, with all these changes everybody's talking about, all you'd have to do is get the rest together and say, hey, we're just going to stop calling it. And after a few weeks, after you turn the ball over, you take a terrible shot and it goes over the backboard and Trae Young or James Harden looking around or Chris Paul getting run over, these guys will stop doing it once you stop calling it. So I hate that play too. But I think Paul does those, especially because it's in front of everyone. You know, that stop in transition, get run over and get the call. It's so egregious and horrible that it's probably thought of, like, in a worse sense in the basketball community than guys just flop to the lane every time. I mean, Harden actually will pull your arm into his body, take the shot, and the other guy's arms are pinned, and then the ref calls it all the time. Like, I can't believe that has ever been called more than once for any player in his career, because we see it all the time. So I actually think there's more floppers on shots and also on drives than Chris Paul. But when Paul does the deal where he lets the guy run up his back, it just looks so much worse because it's the only thing we're looking at.
I also think that Chris Paul, we need to give him some credit, because on a lot of these flops, if he hadn't have flopped, he was about to get hit like a half second afterwards. You can see, like, he has pre-crime in his head. And he knows, like, hey, here comes an elbow. I might as well flop before it hits me. And then, you know, as he's down the ground, the elbow does swing through his airspace. So it's almost like, you know, he's a good point guard. He sees the play before it happens.
Yeah, a lot of it, I think, comes out of just being incredibly competitive. But that's where Harden fans or other fans of other guys. I mean, look, we all know what we're doing. We're all sticking up for the guy that we like. But I still think with Paul, it doesn't happen as frequently as it does with the other guys. And so that's why I feel a little differently about it than just extending out the legs every time. I mean, look, Steph, who I love, started doing it more this year than he's ever done it before, because he's like, look, if you guys are going to keep calling this stuff, I guess I'll start doing it. So I don't really blame the players for doing it. I blame the refs for allowing it to evolve to this point where guys are now mad. Trae Young gets mad while the guy's about to whistle. Like, yes, the ref is about to give him the whistle, and Trey's already mad at him and then stays mad because it's like, you weren't quick enough with the whistle of the bullshit call that I just earned.
So I think you're in the right. Kyle Lowry, douchebag, Everything he does is terrible. Chris Paul, hero. You want him to be your son.
Yeah,
that's how we can kind of sum it up. Yeah. Yeah. Perfectly. Yeah, all right. So the Suns are going to win this series, right?
I think we make mistakes all the time with playoffs, man. We really do. And, you know, say the Suns get game two and they're up 2-0. The desperation level for Milwaukee at home for game three, I say this every single year because I just think it's on point, is you can't fake desperation. You can't be as desperate as Phoenix will be, or excuse me, as Milwaukee would be. Like, you can say the right things. You can do the cool chants, win on three, Suns come running out of the tunnel, but you're up 2-0. And human nature, it's kind of like when there's a lead. Like, Phoenix was totally in control of that game, I thought. They knew they could do whatever they wanted. Milwaukee changed their defense three or four different times. Phoenix was actually surprised sometimes, I think, when they get switches. Like, you could see Devin Booker be like, oh, my God, I can't believe how much time I have to make a decision on what I want to do next. And be like, okay. And then you're up 20. You feel like you're in control. Milwaukee goes small, and you're a little – you know, you're mailing in a little bit, like the 7-8 minute mark of the game. And then Milwaukee got it to 7. And you're like, wait, this is a game? Like, how is this a game? Because it hasn't felt like this. So I think the same thing applies – in series. And, you know, they'll figure out something with Lopez. You know, they didn't bring him back to close this game at all. The same thing happened in game one against Atlanta. They didn't bring him back basically for the last 15 minutes of game one because they felt like his coverage, it just wasn't going to work. So I don't know if Milwaukee will go small again. I don't know if they got back into the game because they went small or Phoenix was up 20. So I am very anti. We see one game, it looks like one team has no chance, especially how they match up defensively, and then think like that's the series. We've all done this for so many years now. We've watched so many series. I mean, how did you feel about the Clippers against Dallas? How did you feel about the Clippers against Utah? And in Utah, the Utah Clippers series looked like two completely different years.
Yeah, no, that was crazy.
It was a matter of days. So even though I like Phoenix going in, and the guard part of this is just overwhelming, and Ayton has turned into a star here in a very short amount of time, I still think there's a version of Giannis being a little bit better. I thought they were a little slow in the first half collectively. I could see a game where their size and Jrue Holiday stepping up, and we're going, oh, wait a minute, maybe Milwaukee's figured some things out. So I don't think there's this massive, massive gap. Although, yes, I pick Phoenix going in.
Okay, so follow-up question. Well, let me just, a side note, that's lame of you to actually be like, hey, I'm going to think about this instead of just saying something and then, like, what we do.
We'll
just be like,
Suns
in four. Yeah, Suns in four, Suns in four.
Yeah, that's not great for your career. Yeah, anyone listening, don't do what I do.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
Don't be thoughtful. So, that's actually the worst possible thing that you can do in sports media.
Yeah. Yes.
TV producers would be like, in the hallway after I do that spiel, they'd be like,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. We'll hit you up after game three.
Yeah. Could you just said Suns in four? If the Suns lose,
the whole thing,
how mad are you going to be when people like me and people like PFT and the rest of us say that Chris Paul is a choker and he'll never win the big one?
Publicly, you won't see much, but privately, I'll see you for about 48 hours.
Do you think that if Chris Paul loses the finals, that should count as a loss for LeBron's finals records as well?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. I hadn't really thought of that way. I think it's only a win. It's only a win. I mean, didn't you say PFT? He's been so supportive of him this entire time.
Yeah. No, I think that I've kind of turned the corner on LeBron this postseason. He's doing his best, shining the spotlight on his good buddy Chris Paul. So if they win a championship, I think that LeBron definitely needs a ring.
Yeah, I don't think it counts as a loss for him, but it definitely counts as a win. Although I did love when Chris kind of went back at him a little.
Yeah.
I mean, LeBron, it was kind of funny how, like, almost, you know, LeBron is a very, like, at this point, it's almost political with him. If you like him, you're like, hey, great point. And if you've already decided you don't like him, then it doesn't matter what he says. But when he said, hey, I told everybody, like, these injuries while he's at home, and people just crushed him. And then Chris Paul's like, hey, dude, we all knew the deal. We're, like, the two most powerful people in the league. And we all voted to come back. So, like, you say what you want, but I'm trying to win a ring here, which is exactly what everybody else would be doing. Like, right. If LeBron were still alive or anybody be saying, like, do you think he would be like, yeah, these playoffs have actually been a lot easier to get through? Of course not. So we all do what's in our own self-interest, especially when you're that big of a deal.
Yeah. I know that there's been a lot of injuries, but there's also been, like, guys sit out a lot during the season. And also a lot of the injuries have been a little bit freakish. You know, I mean, Kyrie
Irving. How
about
Silver?
What'd he say?
Well, Silver, like, pushed back on the whole thing because it's like,
good. Finally standing up to his boss, LeBron.
Would you agree? And I always felt like this way at ESPN. And like, I would say, hey, if you're going to present me with science that's very conclusive about what rest really means and load management and all these things, then you've got me. But you can't be dismissive of the television partnership. You know, right. Business is about partnerships. And if you keep telling one of your business partners, the one that's paying the biggest tab every single season, like, hey, sorry, you guys got another big Saturday game, but our science says this. Because I've asked GMs, like GMs that you would think would be all about rest, being like, you know what, I've looked at everything and it's honestly still a little inconclusive. But I feel like the media side of it has just been in this rest mode for years. I mean, I've talked about this before, but I feel like most media members that cover the NBA are very much pro rest. It's like, hey, you can't have these guys sit enough. And so we have the quick turnaround, which is a lot to ask, both emotionally and physically, which I think all of us understand. But then you had, when you were doing the all NBA voting and you were looking at like the 20 guys for 15 spots, if you were to say, oh, that guy missed 20 games, good luck finding anybody that didn't. Like right. Jokic and Chris Paul, like there were very few guys that played out the entire season. So the best players missed almost a third of this abbreviated season. And then we still had all these injuries. So Silver's basically saying, hey, look, the science is still inconclusive, which is another thing that I think we've all learned. It's like, hey, listen to the medical experts. Those guys disagree with each other all the time. We're just too dumb to understand what their arguments are. So I am not sold on really any argument. I'm not saying it's had nothing to do with the, you know, the injuries have had nothing to do with the quick turnaround, because as you said, a lot of the guys, they're either freakish injuries or guys with long injury histories already. It's just overwhelming. And I think it ends up being turned into that talking point where everybody's on the same page when I'm like, why are you so convinced that you're right? Cause I'm not convinced of either.
Yeah.
Right.
If you land on somebody else's foot, there's no way that you can blame that on like the short turnaround.
Correct.
That just happens in basketball. If it's like James Harden, you got a hamstring injury, then yeah, you could say like, okay, that could be an overuse injury. Just, you know, like given his injury history, might be, it might not be, but you don't really know. I don't know what to do about that either. I just feel like what the players really want is they just want to be like, hey, I'd like a day off. Like it's work sucks sometimes. I'd rather not play every single day if I don't have to. I think most people would understand that, but they're kind of couching it in this like pseudoscience of, okay, if I miss one out of every seven games, I'll be less likely to tear my ACL. And I think that's total bullshit.
But at the end of the day too, LeBron's made all his money. Like, he's made money. So I think that the problem I always had with it is, like, if you're a guy who's working for that next contract and you play way less games and the salary cap goes down and now you're kind of screwed out of that, you're like, hey, wait, you don't speak for me. I want to play. Like, I want the league. I want the cap to go back up. I want all these things to happen. I'm not at the end of my career. I'm at the beginning of my career. So that's where it to me, and Chris Paul kind of said it perfectly, because he is the most powerful guy outside of LeBron and he does speak for the players, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's head of the Players Association.
Right.
So, I mean, if you're talking about, you know, when the first – I mean, it was such a wild time trying to figure out any of this stuff because of the information when we had the first shutdown for 4 months. So then it's like, okay, when's this going to happen? And then you're getting a bunch of people to hear from trainers who are like, these guys are going to need like 60 days just to ramp up to get back to regular season, you know, levels. And you're thinking, okay, well, you could also just not shut it down for four straight months and then have to ramp it back up. Like, there's some responsibility – on the athlete himself to try to maintain some level of conditioning, although nothing's going to match the intensity of a real NBA game. And the NBA still found a way to give him like, hey, guess what, guys, you got 60 days. And I was shocked. And so then they bring everybody back. And I thought it was an unbelievable success for the league to even pull off what they did with the bubble. I know we argued about ratings all the time and all these different things, but it's like, look, we're talking about real extenuating circumstances here. So I think the players and everybody deserved a ton of credit. But when there was talk about like not coming back, and, you know, Michelle Roberts, her position is to just whatever the owners and the league says, she's going to oppose it by definition of what her role is. Like mm-hmm. we've seen that in baseball and football. I mean, that's what the job is. But I kind of sitting there going, all right, so if all the players are cool with losing like $300 and $400 million, then fine, don't do anything. Like if you're cool with that, then okay. But my gut would tell me when you put it to a vote,
right,
it's going to be a lot more, because like that's how social media can be so weird, because you're going, wait, do these guys actually not want to come back and play? And then the vote comes out and it wasn't even close.
No,
it was overwhelming. Like, we don't want to lose all that cash. So I feel like the league has done an incredible job. The players have done a great job. It sucks just like any other fan that all these guys have gotten hurt. I don't want to see anybody get hurt, but I'm just not sure, based on everything I've read, that we have some conclusive evidence that these injuries have happened just because of what we had in the past year. Maybe it's true, but Silver definitely pushed back on it, which I was just at least, I guess I was even surprised, because he's been so pro player as a commissioner.
Yeah.
Well, he's been pro LeBron as a commissioner.
Yeah.
I think there's a big difference. So now he's like, he's finally, you can imagine life after LeBron in the NBA right now. Like you just said it, if LeBron were still alive, for a moment I was like, what, LeBron's dead? Like, you can picture a moment when the NBA does not have him as, you know, the mouthpiece for everything that they're doing. And at that point, like, Adam Silver is going to have to find a backbone and be his own guy.
You're really hammering Silver here, PFT. What's the story?
Well, no, he's just a puppet. He's just, I think everybody knows that Silver, he's a puppet of either LeBron, ESPN, or like the NBA
China,
Reddit.
China.
What about China, Ryan?
Do you disavow China? The entire nation. I'd like you to speak on China as a whole.
What about it, Ryan?
You know what I've learned? I'm not educated enough on the topic, so I'm going to stay out of it. Stay out of all the politics from now on.
Whose property is the South China Sea?
Ooh,
who has fishing rights?
Good question, PFT.
It's something we debate all the time on this podcast.
It's actually how we start every show.
Who has the fishing rights?
Fishing rights. You catch a flounder in the South China Sea.
Who gets to eat it?
Who gets to eat it?
That's a really good question.
Yeah,
like, I don't know. I imagine it's a little different than we thought. I mean, are the Russians involved somehow?
Yeah, you can always say Putin.
Yeah.
That's always an acceptable answer. Okay, let me ask an easier question. Do you believe in Taiwanese independence?
I believe in everybody having the best day they possibly can.
Yeah, okay. That's good. Yeah. Yeah, like live, that. Laugh, love, I think is what will free Taiwan. Just say that.
Yeah.
Live,
more
laugh,
hoodies.
Love. Yeah, live,
more
love.
Hoodies. couple memes. It's like, hey, I did my part. I did an Instagram post the other day.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We've seen you unload some Instagram pictures. I love that. Yeah. I love Hank that excuse,
is,
by the way.
Hank is woke, by the way, about – he's not here right now, but we'll speak for him. You – that angle of you and your jump shot, like that jump shot, you don't – does that go in? Because all you're doing is focusing on jumping high. You're way too high in the air.
Yeah, people thought it was Photoshopped in that one. I dunked it the first time ever at age 45. So, I mean, people have said specimen. I don't like calling myself that because it's kind of like a third person thing. It's weird.
Yeah.
But I got up so high on that one. I was deep and I was just trying to get like, I was, you know where I was? I was on the border of Canada. I was up like upstate New York. I went through a big drive. I was out in the lakes of Vermont. So I did this whole thing. I go, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to try to find different places to play pickup hoops. And then I found the oldest log cabin in the history of the country. PFT. Ooh. I mean, these cabins were moved all over the place.
You know I love log cabins.
Yep, huge log cabin guy.
I'll tell you, easy to heat, right? I mean, those guys had it right. The heating bill on those, no problem. A couple cords of wood get you through the winter, one room, center pipe.
Uh-huh. I love a good wood-burning stove as opposed to a fireplace. It gets hotter.
Yes.
Yeah, and then you can use it to cook.
Yeah. Right on, an egg right on top.
I noticed you didn't answer the question.
Yeah, you totally deflected that.
Was there actually a basketball in your hand when you were starting to shoot that jump shot, or were you just jumping up into the air out on a court?
I actually took
a jumper.
If you had told me that you parachuted and that was the end of the parachute, that would have made more sense.
No, I was taking a jumper. I mean, look, there's a level of loserdom to my Instagram page that only a few appreciate. And then some people are like, maybe you're just really that big of a loser and you use that as an excuse to go ahead and post this dumb shit. But yeah, I had a photo dump and it was going to be like a photo dump of me just taking jumpers at eight different places that I played pickup hoops. But my left foot doesn't really even work right now anyway, so I'm not even that good at pickup hoops anymore. But yeah, I was way out. I was deep. I was Trae Young range when they're trying to get back in the playoffs. Yeah.
I love that explanation, though. It's just a photo dump, just a bunch of pictures I had on my camera. I had to put them on Instagram or else my phone was going to be too full on memory. So good thing I was able to upload this picture of me looking awesome on a basketball court.
By the way, though, that's of all the people that I would expect to appreciate the joke, that was the joke. It was two pictures. It was me taking a jumper.
Oh, yeah.
No, I get it. I just love it.
So, right.
Yeah.
No, that it's right.
Because usually photo dump is like, here's my insane body.
Yeah.
10 shots in a row, and I was in Tulum again.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let's talk about something different. Who, I'll give you an either or. Who finishes first? George R. R. Martin finishes Winds of Winter, or you finish your first script?
Oh, wow. Good question. I've finished. It's me because I've finished scripts. But it was a lot like ESPN. It's like you walk through the doors. You're like, I've made it. And you're like, no. There's a whole nother boss level that's in that other building. And you got to get past that. And you're like, well, how do you do it? And you're like, no one does. So you're like, oh, okay. In writing, you're like, all right, I finished it. And then you send it to your agent. And then you go, now what? And they're like, good job.
Entourage gets made.
Well,
way better. No, but I am. There is something I'm working on now. It's called Wicked Fast, Wicked Furious. And it's a lot of people don't understand the car racing scene in Boston as well as I do. And I would say it doesn't. One of the critiques of my writing is that the storyline can move a little slower, and Fast and the Furious moves fast. I mean, you know, you're in it immediately. And so this takes place in Boston, a bunch of guys, street racers, and the first 20 minutes or so, they don't race because they argue about the best way to get from one side of town to the other.
This has legs, because right. Now you can do, maybe the second one can be whether you take
an actual race.
No, whether you take the 405 or not during rush hour.
Yeah, but they've already done a bunch of LA ones. But honestly, they were like, it's not super diverse. And I go, well, what are you talking about? The casting for it? And they were like, well, there's three Murphs, and I don't think any of them are related. And I was like, yeah, Murph 1, Murph 2, and Murph 3. And that's what leads to confusion in the sequel. And they're like, worry about the sequel. Look, you got to get one made.
Right.
So I don't know. They told me it was a bad idea to just jump on. They're like, they've already made 9 of them. And I was like, exactly. That's my point. Like, I have a way better chance of writing one of these. Wicked Fast, Wicked Furious. And it tracks well, was the other feedback.
What about this? You do an F1 movie. I know that you're really into Formula One, and it's like a fish out of water.
Not as much as you guys.
No. Who do you root for? I mean,
our guy, which car, Daniel Ricciardo.
Which car do you enjoy?
No, we had an ask out to Ricciardo, I think, a month or so before you guys did, and we were told maybe August. And then when you guys got him, like in a day, now I'm open. Yeah, I'm just going to tell you straight up. I didn't listen to the episode either, fucking
guys.
Yeah.
But, well, you know what we did. We just started calling him out on our show.
We bullied him.
We said he won't come on, and then everyone started tagging him and everything, and then he came on.
It's kind of an American thing to do, though. I don't really see the sport that way.
Okay.
You see it as a European does?
Yeah.
I don't know. I just have more respect for these guys.
Well, what you should do is you should do like an F1 movie, Fast and Furious, Wicked Fast, Wicked Furious, and like fish out of water, have it be essentially Ben Affleck and Matt Damon somehow. Like, they're the fastest street racers in Boston, and they find themselves on the F1 circuit going to like Monaco, Budapest, you know?
Oh, maybe
what? Hey, you know what the opening scene is? I just thought of this. When Damon listening to a little Elliot Smith, don't put that on if you're in a bad mood, and then... Nope. Driving cross country, and then Affleck pulls in next to 89, maybe probably Mass Pike because it'd be going west. And then that's the opening scene of the next one. So you transition Goodwill Hunting fast.
Yeah.
And then they're racing each other to get to California because you didn't realize the whole time Affleck was with Mini Driver on the low.
Yeah. Ooh. And then instead of having Ludacris in the side seat, you've got King Casey from Dropkick Murphys in the side seat, and they're just blasting Irish folk music.
You also could have Matt Damon be in maybe the third. He becomes a principal of the principal of the team. I don't know. You're an F1 guy. We're not.
Principal. Yeah, he's like the GM.
Yeah, I mean, Matt Damon, with all his smarts, figures out the best aerodynamic car of all time and beats Toto Wolff, who's actually secretly a Nazi. Not actually Toto Wolff. That's just the, you know, it's based on fiction. So
artistic,
I didn't want to call
license.
Him that. Yeah.
And then.
Yeah. No, that's a good problem. But the problem is, the fourth installment of Wicked Fast, Wicked Furious, they realized that Damon was cheating.
Is also a Nazi.
And then Tom Cruise shows up in the fifth one, takes them all out.
Yep.
Yes.
And
yes.
They're in Monaco. There's a big disaster on the course. There's like construction.
Because Affleck's movie's out for the festival.
Yes. So and you know that Nazis selling movies. There's, like, everyone watches those movies. Always.
They do well.
They always do well.
There's traffic, and Affleck's like, I've seen this before, and he flashes back to the big dig. He's like, I know how to get through this.
That's it. They start start looking at old plans of the big dig, and they're like, no, dude. They're like, it's exit 23, the waterfront. I wish we had written more of this down. I guess that's, we're recording right. this, though.
It's so not really, yeah. These are probably our worst ideas we're getting out. Another thing you should do is just write yourself into it. That way you get a double check.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised we're talking this much about Affleck right now, knowing how Big Cat feels about this situation.
Do you think it was tacky? Do you think it was tacky to wear the same outfit as J-Lo? That's a major tacky.
I don't think it was
look.
Nearly as much the same outfit as it was the Shade Room logo being over it, making it look like they were wearing sweaters that said TNR.
Yeah. And also,
that's why everybody got on their case.
The second picture looked like they were looking at like a car crash. It was weird.
Have you talked to A-Rod about it? Have you addressed this at all?
I sent him a text after they broke up saying, sorry about the breakup, boss, and he just hearted it. That was it.
No way.
That
did
was
you,
it.
You didn't even tell me this.
No, yeah, that was it. That was it.
That was this the last time you've texted
Yeah,
with
this
him?
Last time we've texted. I'm giving him space, you know?
I love that Big Cat became someone. that could get to the point of like, it was 6 years ago. You were like, hey, can you guys be our first guest ever on the podcast? I was like, done. No problem. 2 hours later. Hey, nope. I can't do it. They're not going to let me.
Yeah.
And I used to love it. They were like, you're too important to our brand at ESPN. I was like, am I? I'm like, why don't we just go on with these guys? And they're like, nah, we're not going to do that. I was like, no one's going to listen. Don't worry about it. And then it's like, now, 6 years later, you can text A-Rod after breaking up with J-Lo.
A joke
and he responds.
A joke
right.
text.
Well, he's not going to get it. No. I mean, I don't want this to get back to him. I don't want it to be uncomfortable.
If it does, I can handle it. I know how to work it.
You definitely can.
I know how to
no
work
one,
it.
You have developed into somebody who can be kind of mean and get away with it.
Yes, that's true. But yeah, I mean, this podcast is kind of mean sometimes. It gets away with it.
Like, I think the trick is, as long as you're just funnier than you are mean, it always plays.
Yeah, and you also have to be mean to yourself.
I think Paul Rabel came on the show last week, and he was like, you guys have just built a brand where you can just make just fun of everybody. And he's like, that sucks for me being a guest on your show right now.
But it's like, I said to him after, like, it's a perfect example. Like, I've been very mean about the Water Dogs, our team that we own.
Really
but it's
mean.
Also
I'm getting uncomfortable about this.
But it's also natural because I actually fucking hate the Water Dogs. They suck. They make us look bad. So which one's better? Like, do you want me to throw out a tweet that's clearly an ad, or do you want me to talk about it naturally? I happen to think that the natural conversation, the Water Dogs, and you're a writer, Ryan. Well, sort of.
He's a writer.
You're a writer.
He does write.
Yeah, you do write.
Hobby.
The story arc here.
Expensive hobby.
Yeah, it's set up. This movie has a conclusion where the Water Dogs lift the trophy, and I'm like, I always believed in you guys.
There hasn't been one guy on that lacrosse team to tell you to go fuck yourself yet?
No, not publicly.
I think lacrosse is the one sport, too, where it's like they're just happy to have people talking about them.
I don't know. I saw the last tweet where there was no all-stars from the Water Dogs, and you were like, good.
Yeah, it's...
Well, it's got two endings possible. Either the happy ending where they win, or have you seen Marley and Me?
Yeah.
No.
That's kind of like the ultimate ending.
Mm-hmm.
We're also considering
Old
that.
Yeller.
Why, what happens? What is that, Bob Marley?
Yeah. No, all the dogs die. But they probably go to heaven.
Well, now I'm not going to see it.
Yeah. Speaking of which, why haven't you gotten a dog and been like, I'm taking a step up in my life. I'm starting to get more responsible.
It's a great question. It's been asked a few times. I always say this. I don't want to do that to the dog.
The dog might not like the NBA. He might be a hockey guy, and then you're fucked.
Yeah. He's going to just look at me, like, come up the stairs, be like, oh, writing again?
What kind How's of dog going? Would you get?
You know what's funny is I never was I've told the story before, and it isn't something that does my Q rating any good. But, you know, because my dad was a humble carpenter at the beginning, laying brick, actually, the first few years I was on the job sites with him. He would bring me to every estimate. Because he felt like if he had this little tow-haired kid coming along, he'd have a better chance of closing the deal instead of being like a 6'5 guy with long hair in this pickup truck. So he would show up, and I'd hold the tape measure at the other end, you know, and all the homeowner would always think it was the cutest thing ever. And he knew what he was doing. Mm-hmm. But like estimate, whenever I heard the word estimate after I get picked up at practice or school or everything, I'd just be like, oh, this sucks. Like, I just want to go outside and play wiffle ball. And he'd be like, no, we got to go do an estimate. And that also meant that I got attacked by like everybody's dog when I first showed up at the house. So for a very long stretch, dogs to me, I was like, ah, another fucking dog's going to jump all over me all the time. And then when I got to college, we had a horribly trained dog in our house that used to eat your food as soon as you left, take your spot. I think I remember one night I was like rifling through the fridge, probably super late. So I wasn't 100% with it. And then the dog like hit me. And the freezer door was open because I was getting ice too. And I hit my head on the freezer door and I like knocked myself out in the kitchen. So I've had this horrible, horrible history with dogs. So when people at ESPN would be like, how come you don't get a dog? You're by yourself all the time. And I was just like, you know what? We haven't had a great run. And I see people that, especially when I was traveling all the time, like they get a dog selfishly for those down moments because they're alone. But then it's like, oh, by the way, I'm going to go to LSU for 5 days. So you'll be in a kennel.
Right.
Like, I don't think unless you have a yard, which I don't have out here, the beaches, they don't let you bring the dogs on the beach. That's a big no-no out here. I understand dogs now. I'm open to the idea, but I wouldn't do it unless I were 100% into the dog. And that's probably why I'm not married either. Like, I'm just like, hey, I got to be 100% on this.
You know, you put your wife in a kennel is what you're saying when you go to LSU?
Like, hey, I'm going to be gone a lot. May not talk to you for a couple days. And she'd be like, Dog or me?
I left the toilet bowl open, so if you get thirsty, don't worry.
Yeah, look, I've got a door. You've got my DoorDash, right? I'm sorry, Postmates. I don't know who sponsor is, so go ahead.
You know, you could have just said lab when I asked you that question.
Yeah.
That would have been fine.
Could have said lab.
That's the right way. That's why Russell's the best.
Oh. Here's why everybody should hate me.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's why, you know, I'm not going to do the pander tweets. Like, you know, we're always joking about it. Like, you'll look and see, be like, well, this person definitely doesn't believe that, but they're going to go with this move today. And I just, like, there's certain things I feel the same way as a lot of people do, but I don't feel like I need to be checked off the box. Be like, hey, does Russillo like, you know, healthy infants? I haven't seen him tweet about it yet.
Right.
Like, well, right. Let's not check him off yet until we see him acknowledge that healthy infants are awesome. So whatever.
We're going to get back to Ryan Russillo in a second. Before we do, Coors Seltzer. We love Coors Seltzer. Coors Seltzer is the best summertime drink that you can have. I'm actually holding one right now. I'm holding the Coors Seltzer Orange Cream Pop. This thing is delicious. This thing is, I was going to say it's like crack. They probably would not appreciate being compared to an illegal drug, but it is delicious. It's the tastiest seltzer that I've ever had in my entire life, and it looks awesome too. It's Orange Cream Pop. We all know Orange Cream Pop. It's a nostalgic blend of orange and vanilla with a touch of sweetness to taste like orange cream soda. It's the perfect refreshing treat for a hot summer day. It's 4.5% ABV. It's only 90 calories per 12 ounce and comes in a 12-pack. Orange Cream Pop Coors Seltzer is the official seltzer of the ocean. I just put that on the ocean right now. It's Poseidon's favorite drink, Uranus's favorite drink. If you're going to the ocean, you're drinking a Coors Seltzer Orange Cream Pop flavor. And they're also the official drink of rivers. They're helping restore river water. I think we've saved more than 120,000 gallons of river water so far. The goal is to restore 1 million gallons of river water with 2,000 cases of Coors Seltzer. We love it. And every 12-pack sold refreshes 500 gallons of river water. If we hit 2,000 cases, Hank is going to have to go fishing and prove that he can catch a fish with his bare hands in the East River. In the East River, he's going to be fully submerged, just skin diving. He's going to skin dive it.
I love it.
So skinny dipping, all nude in the East River. Hank will be catching a fish with his bare hands or cheeks or whatever he can use, whatever appendages are available to lasso a wild fish in the East River. Hank will be catching it. That's only if you guys drink enough Coors Seltzer, though. So the goal is to restore 1 million gallons of river water with 2,000 cases. And tweet us a picture of your Coors Seltzer with hashtag LetHankFish. For every pick, we count as one case added to the scoreboard. So get Coors Light and Coors Seltzer delivered straight to your door with Drizzly or Instacart. Or you can go to CoorsSeltzer.com/take. See where you can purchase Rocky Mountain Refreshment now in a hard seltzer. Coors Brewing Company, Fort Worth, Texas. Celebrate responsibly. For every 12-pack sold through 12/31/2021, Coors will purchase services from chains through Coors to restore 500 gallons of fresh river water, max 5 billion gallons through 2021. Details at CoorsSeltzer.com. Here's more Ryan Russillo.
So, all right. So my question. So I told you beforehand I was going to spring it on you. So you don't know what I'm going to say, but you had a line, I think it was probably 3 months ago, that made me laugh so much that I put it down in my notes. And it might not even be funny because I don't even remember the context. But you said you're giving life advice. You're like, listen, I've been a guy for a really long time now. And I was like, what the fuck does that even mean? And it got me thinking, like, Ryan is sitting here being like, I got my guy resume. Like, you could see it. I graduated guy school in, like, 1999. But my question to you is, because I was thinking about it more, I actually think that's a weird thing. Like, when do you become a guy? Because, like, kids aren't guys. Like, even a 19-year-old I don't think is a guy. Because it's a little bit of maturity. It's a little bit of, like, life wisdom. It's a little bit of kind of like, hey, you're not a guy until you stop, like, maybe trying to hook up with your best friend's girlfriend, like, kind of thing. Like, that's not a guy move. So when do you become a guy, and how long have you been a guy?
I feel like, you know, the thing I'm most happy about, however circuitous the path was, is that I wouldn't be as good as a talk show host. And, like, I'd like to think that I've done an okay run here over the last 20 years doing this, but I had to be kind of a you know, like not have it figured out for a really long time. I had to bartend. I had to have those moments where I'm like, this isn't going to work out. And then studying for a general contractor's license and then having other moments where like nothing is working out. And then being so single-minded, it's like literally the only thing you care about while still, you know, trying to keep up with your friends and have like a normal life when you can't really have a normal life when you were doing what I was doing in the beginning at ESP. Like I was driving back and forth and living in a hotel room. I think I stayed in a hotel like 200 nights the third year I worked at ESPN because I just was like, I don't care. This is the only thing I care about. So instead of just going to Syracuse and immediately like having enough networking that you can get your foot in the door in this industry that is so hard and I think it's harder all the time, I think those experiences of just being an idiot and getting stuff wrong allows me to be in a better position to give people advice. Cause there's other people being like, how can you give anyone advice? You don't have any kids. You've never been married. And it's like, yeah, but everybody's already, most people have done that. And if you did it earlier, there's not as many life experiences for me to like see a guy emailing and he's like, hey, so this is, you know, some guy who's 25 who goes, hey, so, you know, there's a girl at the gym and she's super flirty with me, but she doesn't respond to my texts. And then when she sees me, she's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't respond to your text, but you know, blah, 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 blah. And it's like, dude, it's really simple. Like people have been on both ends, or if you have, you know, zero game, I guess you've never been on the other end of it, but like you don't ignore somebody that you're interested in, right? You know? And at 25, you'll still have these moments of like, wait, what kind of game is being played? And you're like, actually, it's a very simple one. Like she's probably seeing somebody else. She likes the attention from you at the gym. And if she's dating somebody, he's not there. So that fills some sort of void for her, those interactions that you have with her. And like, you just have to be around long enough. And people could listen to this and say, yeah, obviously, idiot. Like, thanks for the doctorate in something really simple. But it still feels like so many people miss these signs. And then there's certain things that we'll miss too. So I guess, again, it's a long-winded answer of it, but I'd had to have all those ups and downs and different experiences, and dating is obviously part of it too, where you're like, okay, well, I've already had this happen to me, or I did this to somebody, so I know exactly. So that's my answer being a guy, and I'd say it probably, unfortunately, has gone a little bit longer, but probably kicked in the mid-20s.
Well, mid-20s. Okay.
How does it work out now if you do something that's decidedly un-guy? Do you have to
– Yeah.
Are you guy enough to look yourself in the mirror and check your guy-dom, or do you need another guy – like buddy system to be like, hey, Ryan, that's not a guy move.
Pull you over.
Hey, yeah.
Slap you in the face. Be like, hey, dude, what are you doing? You're a guy.
The only person checking on me is me. So, you know, the isolation people, my friends were joking that you're the most built for this of anyone we know, going through it all. But I'm harder on myself than anybody else could possibly be. So I try to keep myself in check, but you know, whatever. It's weird because, I mean, we're getting a little deeper here, but I can think about my career and all the stuff I've accomplished and having a nice house and all this stuff, which seemed impossible and everyone would have bet against 20 years ago. But then sometimes I'll think like, was I just really successful? But like, I still haven't even come close to figuring it out. Like, do I think I have it completely figured out and everything's going to be nice and easy now the rest of the way? Or do I constantly trying to make things really hard on myself where I can only operate with massive challenges, like trying to become a screenwriter, like as much as we bullshit and joke about it, this isn't easy. It's really, really hard. And here I have something that's really successful, and yet I have this other thing that is really the thing that I'm trying to figure out how I can do it. And most of my friends are like, why can't you just chill the fuck out and have a really successful podcast and a really nice life as you go into your 50s? I'm like, well, I also don't know if I want to be giving out dating advice to college kids when I'm 55 years old on a podcast.
Okay. What that just signaled to me is when you figure out the writing part, we are going to see Ryan Russillo try to make an NBA team with that sick jumper. You're like, I need another challenge. Here we go.
I want to see you compete for an EGOT, but not necessarily like the actual awards. I just want you to have gotten paid for something in all of those categories. Mm-hmm. That's your personal EGOT.
Grammy's going to be tough.
Spoken word. Narrate your own book.
Mm.
I've actually been working on some of my spoken word.
Really?
Give me a sample.
Seasons. There's four. Why only four? Who is in charge of the seasons? Not you. Fall ahead of spring or behind? In which order are the four? Summer, I'm here for it.
That was beautiful. That was fucking beautiful.
All right, now we're going to get that spoken word Grammy because it was recorded on our show.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But think about what I just said, though. Don't let the moment. Don't let the moment just pass by.
No, I definitely think about it. I do agree with you though. Your life advice.
It's kind of crazy. We've only had four though, with all the innovation.
Yeah. Well, I mean, L.A. does. What does it have? One.
It gets a little chilly here in the winter in Manhattan Beach.
Like 60.
There was a 50-degree night.
Oh my God! Jesus Christ!
You okay?
Oh man!
You leave the water dripping in case the pipes froze.
Your car on? You left your car on, didn't you?
There is nothing. Well, it's not always funny because a bunch of bad shit happens. But when you have those security camera community message boards, that's the most unforgiving interaction in the human race. Like, and again, granted, too, it's 4th of July. And then somebody would be like, is anyone hearing gunshots? I'm over in Hawthorne. And you're like, it's the 4th of July. But somebody would just be like, hey, here's a video of a person breaking into my car at 3 a.m. And it's like, why'd you leave your fucking doors open, moron? You're like, okay, my kids' toys were stolen in my baby seat. And it's like, shouldn't have left the doors unlocked. The reason I bring any of that up is that if it gets down to 50, people are like, hey, does anyone have firewood?
Yep.
This is a problem. Yes. Yeah. We're going to Mexico.
Shellbax is doing a hoodie donation fundraiser right now, so just go outside and donate whatever hoodies. This is going to get down to 49 next week.
I love that bar. It's a great bar.
Can I ask PFT a question while we're on the arts?
Yeah.
We have like
3-4 more minutes. Yep. We have interview with Toto Wolff next, so
must be nice.
Yeah, ask away.
Do you want us to give you Daniel Ricciardo's number?
He's out here in LA. I did think we would hit it off.
Oh, that now, makes it worse.
Know.
Yeah,
I know. Damn. I know. Hmm. But I think I may have the inside track. No pun intended, to F1 in Texas. But now when I say it to you, you guys have like set up a merch tent there.
Yeah, yeah. No, we're racing. Yeah. We're actually both driving.
You guys are actually.
Yeah, the Haas car.
Haas was like, so bad.
Yeah, they're like, couldn't get worse.
I wish more people understood. Because I don't even like making fun of Haas after watching the TV show because I feel bad for the owner being like, eh, this sucks. But like they had a 17, 18 position. I was like, not a bad weekend for Haas.
Yeah, they're kind of on the car.
Crash.
I wish more people could understand Haas jokes. All right, if you guys have to run, then let me just ask you this and then you can ask me whatever because I'll be. Why do you hate Yellowstone so much, PFT?
I don't hate Yellowstone. I actually don't hate it that much at all. I love season one. I thought season two was pretty good. But then season three, I was watching for the scenery because every episode was like, Rip, I need you to beat the hell out of this guy. And then Rip would go beat up somebody. And then Cole Hauser would have like sex with his wife, but they'd start crying before they had sex. Then they'd have sex and then Cole would leave. And that was every show. But the background, the scenery was incredible. Then Kevin Costner would be like, grandson, go get a cookie. And that's like that's every episode from start to finish. Oh, and then somebody dies. Someone always dies. And it was just like that repeated, you know, one right after the other. But I still liked it. I still watched it because I was like, this show can become good again at some point. But it got a little repetitive.
All right, that's fair. Because Sheridan, the writer for it, I mean, he's the all-timer. You know, Wind River, Hell or High Water, and then Sicario.
Right.
We had the producer Sicario that had to like bring him in, say, hey, we need to change the end of this. And Taylor was like, nah, I don't even want to do that. But I would love a challenge of trying to speak in full Yellowstone, an entire podcast. Mm-hmm. See how long we could go. Because you'd just be like, hey, Rip, want to head into town and kill some people? And then Rip just turns and goes like, people been killing this town for decades.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like everything like has a meaning to it. There's another layer and it's about saving that area of the country.
The true nature of a man can be told from how clean his horse is.
Men are a lot like fence posts. Got to dig them out of the shit and set them straight every now and then.
If you see a buffalo heading east, you best head west.
I'm just Michael Scott right now being like, I wish I understood any of this.
All right, what else did you have?
That was it. No, that was it. I got to watch it, I guess.
Strong?
Two kids has killed my TV watching ability, so I apologize. I'll catch up.
It's a good watch.
It is.
I literally don't have hours left in the day, so I will try, though.
If for nothing else, just the scenery, like the backgrounds in every scene. Even like in those later episodes, I would still watch every one because it's like there are mountains there.
Yeah. I'm going to watch
it. You know what's really good?
What?
The Wire.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. I'm going to catch up to that, too.
Who did it?
Sopranos. I'm going to watch that soon as well. It's on my list.
You're kidding, right?
Yes, I have. We spoiled the whole fucking thing because Hank was on
episode two, or no, season two, and we just started. He told us he was on season two, and we just spent the next, like, actually, it's still ongoing. It's like 2 years ongoing.
We just like to remind them, like every 3 months, hey, Tony kills Christopher.
Yeah.
Holds his nose mm-hmm. after the car accident.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, obviously you guys are going to do that to him, but if you're that far behind it.
Right. It's like, it's been 15 years or whatever. Like, I remember watching it live in college, the last episode. So, 2007, I think. Yeah. And I thought my cable went out, like everyone else in America.
Yeah, I was in a hotel room.
Oh, surprise.
Your own hotel
room?
One
of 200 in a year.
Layup joke. Tease you right up for that one.
Yep.
All right, well, Ryan, thank you. Suns in four was your prediction?
No, Suns in six.
Suns in six. Okay, and don't worry. If the Suns blow it, we will be nice to Chris Paul.
No, you won't.
No, we won't. We won't.
That's the game. So,
that is the game. You know. And guess what? If the Suns do win, we're the biggest Chris Paul fans in the world. So you really can't win in any way with us.
I'm winning life just being friends with you guys.
There it is.
I love it.
There it is. Get a dog. He could have just said, like, Chihuahua, too.
Yeah, he
could have
said,
literally. That would be funny, like, big man, little dog.
Anything. Instead, it would have been really funny. He was like, here's a story about my father.
Yeah. Here's a story about how my father used me.
Sorry, I love my dad, guys.
Yeah, he sounded like you love him when you were in the truck getting fucking berated.
Iron sharpens iron.
Yeah.
If you want a real truck, go to Chevy. Chevy will get you a truck that will give you good memories with your father.
Yeah, we never had four-wheel. So, you know, that was a big thing when I got old enough to buy my own car. I was like, I'm going to get four-wheel. All right, so this pod's obviously peaking. So,
I think it's no coincidence that you were traumatized in a Ford.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no, a lot of miles there, though. Yeah. A lot of miles. A lot of good memories. Except for the bad games.
Was that the car that Kennedy got shot in? Was that?
Oh, that was a Cadillac.
Oh, it was a Cadillac.
That was a convertible.
I forget because Ravel. It's been a while since Ravel tweeted out an 8K.
Wait, you thought JFK got shot? He was riding in the back of a pickup truck.
No, a Ford. No, a Ford convertible. I don't know, Mustang. Fuck it. No, I knew he wasn't in a pickup truck.
We should just implant that memory into people's brains. So, you know, he was riding an F-150.
If he was riding Chevy, it would have been fine.
It's not safe.
Yeah, it would have been fine.
High country Chevy.
No president has ever been assassinated in a Chevy.
I actually might tell my son that, like, don't ride in the back of a truck. It's not safe. That's how JFK got caught.
Growing up, man, JFK stuff, like, that was crazy. I was thinking about that the other day. Like, all the
how
weird,
old
like,
are you?
No, but it was prior to the JFK movie coming out.
Yeah.
But no, there are always little reminders, whether it's you, me, Long talking, you know, PFT usually, and we only talk history. I sent him something recently that I thought he was really going to enjoy. I'm reading this General Custer book.
Yep.
And there was a guy in his army. He used to he would send love letters to his wife, and he would draw pictures of his erect penis in the letters.
He would trace
these guys, right. So these guys researching his story as one of the guys in this army in the 7th Cavalry, like, found correspondence between this guy in the army and his wife, and they were like, yeah, he was pretty into his wife.
I just don't I don't understand how you verify that it was erect. That's making a pretty big assumption.
Yeah, he could have.
That's why scholars, hey, look, history goes to the winners.
Grower versus shower.
That's true.
All right, we do have to go, though. Thank you, Ryan. Appreciate it.
We covered a lot there in the end.
We did.
A lot of rapid fire stuff.
All right.
Thank you.
Talk to you later.
Good seeing you, buddy. Before we get to Andre Drummond, I want to talk to you about Roback. We love Roback. I was wearing Roback all week this week. The guys over at Roback have been sending us their performance polos, hoodies, and tees for a while now. We'll be honest. When it comes to quality, Roback just blows it out of the park every time. I opened up a new Roback polo this morning, actually, because I needed to wear something with buttons earlier in the day. Not usually my style during the summertime. But their polos are amazing. They're like if a Hawaiian shirt could become a classy polo shirt. They do a great, great job over at Roback. They're super comfortable, perfect for the golf course, for going out. Their prints are fire, just high quality all around. They've got new performance hoodies, are a total game changer. They're the softest, stretchiest hoodies in the game, built for alphas like Jake Marsh. We literally wear them all the time when Jake lets us. Third, Roback Silver Line Performance Tees. These may be the most underrated performance tees out there. Better than Lululemon, Roback's performance tees prevent odor. They wick away sweat. They keep us cool all summer long. In all honesty, Roback has been gaining traction big time Every time you see someone wearing Roback, you just give them that subtle little nod because you know they get it, which makes sense because the brand was founded by award-winning listeners. So use the code TAKE on Roback.com for a generous 20% off your first purchase through the end of this week. That's spelled R-H-O-B-A-C-K.com, and you get 20% off all polos, Q-zips, hoodies, and tees when you use promo code TAKE. They just dropped new performance polos that will have you feeling good and looking fresh. We love Roback. And here he is, Andre Drummond.
And now for something completely different.
Okay, we now welcome on a very special guest. It is NBA. Can we say superstar? Do you want to be a superstar? Are you former superstar, going to be a superstar? Where are you at in your superstar?
Superstar.
All right, Andre Drummond, he is joining us. He's got an NFT collection launching on Friday, July 9th. On Rarible, four NFTs, a mix of auction items and first come first serve. So go check it out; it will be awesome. And also, you get an opportunity to play 2K with you. Are you good at video games?
I'm pretty good.
I don't know about that.
Do you remember like a couple years ago when Cardale Jones was playing against a kid? I think it was a kid in the hospital, and he beat him like 95-10 in Madden.
Yeah,
I did. Yeah, but that's not cool at all.
So you would take it easy?
Nah, I'm definitely gonna play, but. When it's time to win, I'm going to win.
Okay.
All right, so it's great to have you on. Obviously, your season didn't end the way you wanted to end. How are you doing right now? Are you like, what does that look like right after the season ends? Do you get a couple weeks to just hang out and party, or are you back already in the gym shooting and getting ready?
I'm already back in the gym now. It took maybe like 2-3 weeks off just to chill, but you know, I didn't really have that. I didn't play that much this year. You know, I sat out for about 2 months when I was in Cleveland, so I wanted to keep my body going. So I'm still working on my body and, you know, continuing my work.
What are you working on right now? Is there something like – I've always wondered that about NBA players who play at a superstar level like yourself. If you're already really good at your job, how do you decide what you're going to do different in the offseason?
It's more so just polishing things, not even adding anything. Like I feel like some guys – you know, add different elements to their game. But I think for me, I'm pretty consistent in what my job is, and I know what is asked of me. So I have a specific regimen that I just do to just continue to keep my body going and, you know, try to get as strong as I can, as fast as I can, as big as I can, you know, throughout the year.
How much are we working on free throw shooting?
Well, if you have noticed, I'm shooting at least 70 right now.
Hell yes.
So I think that's something I've conquered already.
Yeah, you have gotten a lot better. And we've talked to guys, and it's what was it earlier in your career? Was it just mental? Like what were you able to do to get over that hump and be like, hey, here I am feeling consistent? Because obviously we see Giannis in the finals right now. He's struggling. Like, what would you give a tip for Giannis if you could?
I know for me personally, it was a mental thing for me. You know, I had so many people telling me different ways to shoot it. And, you know, I listen to so many people, mentally it throws you off when you get to the line. Cause you're like, damn, this guy told me this, somebody else told me this. And, you know, I got to a point where I was like, you know, I got to do what's best for me. So I found a routine and shot it the same way for the entire summer. And it's been my routine ever since.
I noticed that you picked up on what we're trying to do, which is like an old school media tip, like mm-hmm. get you to say something
yeah.
so that the headline is then Andre Drummond has free throw tips for Giannis.
Yes.
And then it looks bad on you. So let me rephrase that real quick. If there's a hypothetical league MVP, plays big man position, very strong, takes 11, 12 seconds to shoot each free throw, but they're struggling at the line, how would you specifically tell that person to improve? Again, not Giannis.
Good question. Great question.
Not Giannis.
Not Giannis.
Suns in four.
Suns in four. There it is. Okay.
I love it.
Perfect.
I love your ability to rebound. I always think that people who are really sick at rebounding don't get as much shine as they should sometimes. When you have a 20 rebound game, is that like in the zone? Same as like when a shooter gets hot? Would you consider yourself to be in the zone?
Yeah, when I have a 20 rebound game, this active night for me, that means I'm going after every rebound. And, you know, it's one of those feel-good nights when you see that number up there, because not too many people are able to do that.
Can you tell, like, if you're having one of those nights, can you tell where the miss is going to go before the shot even remotely comes close to the basket?
I mean, I could do that normally, but, you know, just like when you're in that zone, it's just like everything goes right.
You remember, like, when Dennis Rodman was explaining how he was picking up rebounds, like, over here, over there, from was that the Michael Jordan documentary?
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me one thing as like somebody who's really good at rebounding that the average person who might play pickup basketball might not know about where to expect the ball to go?
Well, it depends on where the shot is taken. Like if somebody shoots a shot in the left corner, you know, more times than not, it's going to either overshoot or bounce off the rim towards you. So be on the right side of the rim, or if you're shooting in the middle, just stand in the middle of the rim, you have either way to go. So it's really just knowing where the ball's coming from.
I am a big fan of Jim Calhoun. You played for him at UConn his last year. Do you have any good Jim Calhoun stories? I just like his press conferences because Jim Calhoun never gave a fuck, and he always just told people exactly what was on his mind. So was he like that, you know, in practice, games, like in private settings? Was he just like that, like Jim Calhoun? I'm going to tell you exactly what I'm thinking.
Yeah, he never held his tongue. I mean, funny story about him. I remember we were playing in Rutgers. He'll probably kill me for telling this story, but I think I dribbled the ball coast to coast and turned it over, and he calls a timeout. So I'm running to the timeout. He grabs me by my jersey and throws an uppercut to my stomach, slaps me in the face, says, sit down.
It worked, right?
You put me in two possessions later. So you ready to play now?
So wait, so let's like expand on this, because we see it all the time with Izzo. Izzo will grab a player, and you'll see guys like Draymond Green be like, "Hey, listen, that's how Izzo coaches. Like, that's all love."
Yeah.
So from like the Twitter, like media perspective, what do people get wrong when they see something like that? Like that it's totally, we see it and people overreact when it's like the players who play for the guy are like, no, that's not how it goes.
So I think for me, it's just the relationship you have with that coach. I mean, I don't think he just does it to anybody, but if you have that type of relationship with your coach where he knows how to get the best out of you and what to do to wake you up, I don't think it's anything wrong with that.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, I agree. I always kind of like when those things happen, because you do see a bunch of like media dorks be like, how could he? And then you see all of the former players be like, I know how he could, because we fucking love him and we'll die for him.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I'm just going to read you a tweet. You can put it through the Andre Drummond translator and tell me what this hypothetical player might have meant by this. Lol, remember, kids, control what you can control and let the rest take care of itself. Prayer hands. That was sent before it was sent actually these playoffs before game 6 of Lakers Suns. So what would that person have meant by that tweet?
I think it's self-explanatory.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, control what you can control. I mean, it depends on whatever you're going through, whatever aspect it can be. Whatever, be too high or be too low.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So maybe when you're in the game, be ready to go, but you can also be mad that maybe you're not in the game enough.
Well, I feel like for anybody, it depends on what they're going through.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be basketball.
Do you feel soft because an avocado took you down?
Yeah, a little bit. It's kind of depressing. Punk-ass avocado took me out.
So explain that story. Avocado legitimately, like, kept you out of a game.
Yeah, for like 4 games. We were in Mexico City. I went out to dinner with some of my friends, and one of my friends who happens to be Spanish, I told him to take me to a restaurant so he can go eat. So we get there, and I said, whatever you do, just make sure there's no avocado on my food. I said, can you translate that to them? He's like, yeah, I got you. So he tells her, I order my food. That's it. Before she leaves, I pull her by her shirt. I said, hold on, Marty. Tell her again, no avocados. Cool, thumbs up. Food comes out. My bowl is green. So I got ceviche, so my bowl is green. So I'm looking at it. I said, what's this in my bowl? She's like, oh, no, you're good. No avocado. I said, are you sure? I said, Marty, ask her, please, if there's is there avocado in there? So she says no. So I'm all right, whatever. So I'm eating. I think maybe like 10, 15 minutes go by, and I'm almost done. And I'm just having a conversation. My throat starts to itch. You know, my body like started to itch a little bit. So I look down at my plate. Tell me why there's a big-ass strip of avocado at the bottom of the ceviche bowl.
Oh.
So I didn't know how bad my allergies were. This is my first time having a bad like reaction to it. So I didn't know how bad it was going to get. So I'm like, all right, my throat's itching. I was like, I'm getting stuffy, whatever. So like I took like a Benadryl or whatever. So I go back to the hotel. My eyes like itching really bad, like to the point where I can't even keep it open. So I was like, all right, I'm going to sleep. So I go to bed. I get up the next morning, only one eye opened.
Oh, shit.
So So you can imagine, like, yo, what the hell's going on?
Right.
I'm like trying to pry my eye open. It's like glued shut. So I went to the bathroom. I got a warm top put on my eye. So when I finally get to see it, it's just bloodshot red. There's a bunch of yellow mucus coming out of it, like just disgusting. So I tell my team, I said, hey, I don't know what's going on with me, but my eyes aren't opening. So I go see a doctor to give me some eye drops. And I played. But like, I only played with one eye. Like, I barely could see out of my left eye. Like, it was like almost shut if you watch that game in Mexico City. And yeah, after that game, I couldn't play again. My eyes started burning. It kept getting crusty. So
fuck. An avocado injury is a hell of an injury.
Yeah, how many rims could you see when you just had one eye working?
Oh, that is a good one. You are good.
Yeah. You are good. When you saw that that press conference, it was funny, right? We can all admit that it was a very funny thing to happen because the end of the game was so, I mean, it was spectacular. He played a hell of a game, but then he gives that comment, and it's just, that's one of the funniest things I've ever seen.
You know, I'm not in the interview with that man. That's what he thought was appropriate to say, so he said it.
All right, so I have to bring up the night. I know you fixed your free throw shooting, but you did have a night that you missed 23. What happened after that? Like, what did you say? Do you go into the locker room after you're like, hey, guys, don't worry, I got this. Like, I'm gonna shoot some shots after the game. Like, it was just – that was totally random. Like, what did you – did anyone look at you? Like, I would imagine it's got to be a bad feeling, right?
I think we won that game, actually. So I don't think there was much that was said, but everybody knew in the locker room what each other was thinking. Like, you got to figure this shit out at some point in time. Like, you know, we can't play like this.
You got to – eventually you're going to have to figure – because I do remember, too – I think it happened against the Bulls. I was watching the game. You went double air ball in two free throws. So, yeah, but you figured it out. So we can laugh about this now, right?
We can laugh about it now. It's not a sensitive subject anymore.
Yes. At one point it was sensitive. Now you're good. It would be funny if you did an NFT of the double air ball, though.
You know what? I might have to do that.
You should, actually, because I know you – I said at the beginning, you're doing what is it? You got four NFTs? Maybe add two more. Airball one, airball two on the rare double airball free throw trip.
That one might actually be more expensive.
Yeah, I would buy that one.
Yeah, there's definitely a market for it.
I might have to do that.
What was it like? We're like best friends with Blake Griffin. No big deal.
Oh my god.
Yeah, what was it like playing with him? Like we're legitimately like he's our best friend.
No, I love Blake.
How much do you love him though? Like we love him more.
I think we're on the same scale.
Really?
Yeah. Do you have his phone number?
Nah. Do you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you think he'd pick up a FaceTime?
If I called him?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Maybe. Let me see.
All right. Let's try him, and then I'll try.
Tell him it's his favorite podcasters or second favorite podcast.
Who starts first? You or me?
You go first.
All right. Let's see.
Uh oh.
See Blake.
Is it ringing?
You guys probably said for the show too.
Uh oh.
Ironically, he was the answer for you, right?
Oh, if he answers for me and not you, that's gonna be bad.
He's not hitting the ignore button. He's letting it ring out.
Come on, Blake. Come on, man.
Oh no!
Imagine being Blake and then getting that FaceTime and then getting he's got to know something's up.
All right, go ahead. Your turn.
Pretty quick,
oh, man. If he answers this is gonna be bad for you.
He's gonna answer for him. I already.
Fuck! I think he's probably doing something cool. Because he's a cool guy. He's probably on a boat somewhere with his fucking shirt off, looking awesome. All right, tell us your best Blake Griffin story, though.
Best Blake Griffin story. I think going to his comedy show, his stand-up.
Did he make all his teammates go and was like, hey, you guys legally have to come and laugh?
No. Like, come here and laugh at my jokes. No, he was actually really good. I think it's one of my favorite memories of playing with him is going to that and seeing him in that light because everybody knows Blake is. You know, an aggressive player. So to go see him in like a funny setting, comedy setting was amazing for me.
He is more like we always say, like there's athlete funny and like there's real funny. Blake Griffin's real funny.
He's very funny.
He's real life funny. Like he's hilarious.
Right.
Yeah. Were you ever like, hey, it's hilarious how you never dunk anymore?
No. Didn't he dunk for the first time this year in like 3 years?
Yeah, but then he couldn't stop dunking.
Yeah.
You know, all of a sudden, he's dunking again in the playoffs.
Yeah. Interesting.
Suspect. Interesting.
I got a question for you about a very specific skill that you have. You're really good at shooting full court shots. You might be the Steph Curry of the full court heave. Is that something that you practice, or does that just come naturally?
No, I think that's just natural. Me, it's just strength. I don't really have to try, so I just put it up there.
Do you aim for a bank shot, or do you just aim at the basket itself?
I aim at the back of the rim.
If we were to give you, let's say, 100 shots in a gym, and you have to take it from the other free throw line, do you think your free throw percentage would be higher on that, or your free throw percentage higher in like your second year from the actual free throw line?
It's a good question.
Thank you.
Really good question.
He's doing the math right now.
Yeah. He is. He's crunching the math, and he's trying to figure it out.
I think it'll be even.
Yeah.
It'll be even, yeah. Why do you wear only one leg sleeve? That bothers me.
Does it?
Yeah, big time. It's a stupid look. I'm serious. Like, it is. Like, if you're gonna do the leggings, do both.
I don't want to.
Why?
I want one leg coat and one.
Does it matter which one? Does it always have to be the same?
It could be either one. Doesn't matter.
Really? So you do alternate?
Sometimes. I want one on the right one time and another one on the left side.
Really? So it just makes no sense? You're just doing it to do it?
Yeah, it's a look.
It's a bad look. I'm just, from one guy to another, I'm just telling you, change that look.
What about the shooting sleeve? You ever wear a shooting sleeve?
Only if my elbow hurts.
Yeah, does that actually help? I've always wondered that about compression sleeves.
Oh, like, not really. Only if you fall. I mean, in that case, yeah, it does work.
To, like, protect you against floor burn or whatever.
Say it again?
To, like, protect against floor burn or whatever on your elbow, right?
Nah.
it just looks
looking at
sick.
It's like you guys have never.
I think some guys wear because it's cool. I mean, some guys wear for the compression, and some people wear it with the pads, and, you know, if they got bad elbows.
Gotcha. Are you still on a beer a day diet?
No, but I just had one a minute ago, though.
Okay, so wait, what was the beer a day diet?
You know, it was something I wanted to try out. I wanted to cut out carbs for a little bit, and that's what I came up with.
So you just did one beer every day, no matter what?
Yep.
But that's a carb. So you wanted to cut out carbs, but then?
Bad carbs.
Got it. So that's actually a good point. Okay.
Beer is good carbs.
Good carbs, yes. Okay, that actually, are you? You should be a science. You should be a nutritionist.
Thank you, man. That's why I smoke.
Imagine just sitting down and being like, all right, so here's what we're going to do. No more pizza, but you're going to just drink beer every day.
Yeah. What was the earliest beer you ever had during the beer a day diet?
That's a good question.
Did you ever have breakfast beer? Do beerial, pour right into the cornflakes?
9 a.m.
Yeah.
9 a.m.
If you have a beer for breakfast, the rest of your day, it just flies right by.
Man, why don't you tell me about this?
Tell us what's going through your mind right now. Are you like, wow, these guys are wildly disrespectful?
No, not at all.
It's just a different interview.
Yeah, a lot. Very different. I wasn't not expecting this. I came in here blind. So
okay, now
that's your guy Mike's fault. He should have known.
Yeah, he didn't do a good job of telling me what was going on, but I'm enjoying myself.
He literally watched us go to Maury Povich and like spit water everywhere and do like suck it. Triple H suck it, like when he was a producer there. So that is his fault.
Well, I'm enjoying myself. So
okay, all right, good. That's all we. Yeah. That's all we care about.
And just
so,
like guys talking, one guy talking to another. Like, okay, we're done with all the weird hard questions and stuff. So where are you going to play next year?
What?
Name five of your favorite cities in the NBA.
Shanghai, China.
Oh, okay. Your career's going that bad. What would you say if you went to Shanghai, China to play for the Sharks and then Frank Vogel got hired there and he's like, you're back to 15 minutes a game? Andre Drummond has left the interview. He's left the screen. That would actually be very funny, just a prank. Yo. He's like, hey, you didn't think I'd be here, huh? Like, guess what? We're not going to be using you.
How about we just – let's just say the names of just random cities in the United States, and you just give us your reaction.
Yeah, okay.
Charlotte.
Okay, that was a nod. Utah. Okay.
New York City, the Big Apple.
Mm.
Ooh, that was an emphatic – that was a –
Dallas? Oh, Yeah, Luka. You like Luka? Oh, two thumbs up. Two thumbs up on Luka.
Los Angeles. Clippers.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, interesting. Oh,
no disavow.
Yeah.
He's weighing it out with his hands. I like
that. Portland. Hmm. Dame's not there, though. No.
Cleveland.
Oh, you're going to say yes to everything if you just said yes to Cleveland.
Detroit.
That was good. Detroit's your favorite.
He's coming home. Your agent must love you. Your agent must be like, this guy gets it. Unlike the hockey players who'll be like, yeah, I've already told my agent I'm going to re-sign here. I don't care about money, so just get the deal done.
Right.
You're like, anywhere is fine.
Except a dameless Portland. You're in for everything.
Yeah.
That's it. So we're going to actually twist that around and make that the quote. Andre Drummond says he will not be going to Portland if Damian Lillard gets traded.
Make sure there's some quotes, too.
Yeah, that would be a big-time headline.
You know what would be huge, actually, for us? If you could just tweet out the eyeball emoji tomorrow. You don't have to tweet anything else, just the eyeball emoji.
Yeah.
Isn't that funny how you can tweet, like, literally anything, and there will be six different articles that will come out analyzing what your tweet could mean?
It's crazy.
We did that with Blake when, I don't know, like probably like 3 or 4 years ago. He just tweeted out the eyeball emoji, then the next day the show came out and we were like at the moment where it's like, hey, just tweet out the eyeball emoji, and everyone freaked out because NBA Twitter's weird. What do you think about like NBA Twitter and the obsession with all the storylines? Do you think it's weird? Do you think it's like lame?
I think it's funny. You know, like the other day, like the viral thing that's going on now about how I said, tell y'all coach play me if you want to see me play better.
Yeah.
It's funny. When I did that comment, I'm like, this is going to stir up so much trouble. I called Mike. I said, look what I just did. He's like, all right, well, this is good.
Yeah.
I said, I know.
Yeah.
I know. I have people's attention now. So now I was capitalized on this. I kept going. So I went to Twitter, started a rant there. So then I was like, all right, well, just while I got your attention, I'm dropping an NFT on Friday. I'll go check that out. And, you know, the whole narrative changed.
I love it. That's the way to do it. And you also did when Skip Bayless said Kareem Abdul Drummond. You retweeted that. Yeah.
Merch coming soon.
Really? I might buy one of those.
Do you like that nickname better, or do you like being called the Big Penguin?
What?
You know that the Big Penguin is your nickname.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Why?
I guess people found out my favorite animal is a penguin and put big in front of it.
Wait, that's... You pretended like, what? Why would that ever happen? Your favorite animal's penguin?
It is.
So that's...
It should also be the highest compliment, right? Yeah. If you love penguins. I don't think you love penguins as much as you think that you do.
It sounds like you're kind of a fraud penguin fan.
Did you cry when the gay penguins got married in New York?
I don't think I should answer that question.
Yeah. No, I mean, it was a beautiful moment.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
It was beautiful.
That also might have been in Pawnee, Indiana on Parks and Rec now that I think about it. But you actually love – what's your favorite thing about a penguin?
I just like them. I have kids. They watch Happy Feet, so.
Okay. I still don't think you're a big penguin fan.
That's a personal choice.
Yeah, no, but I'm looking at you right now, and I'm like, this guy – you wouldn't even – what is it? What's the difference? Penguins is king penguin?
Emperor penguin.
Emperor penguin.
Pittsburgh penguin.
Yep.
That's about it. Those are the two kinds.
That's all we got. Oh, Youngstown State Penguins.
That's right. Pete, right? Pete the penguin.
Pete the penguin. Yeah,
Youngstown State.
Uh-huh.
I'm looking at a picture. It looks like at one time you were a giant penguin fan. I'm seeing a picture here of you with your arms around about a dozen penguins.
Oh.
You've got penguin socks on. But it sounds like you've kind of had a falling out. Thawing out, really.
It does.
Yeah, that's a good one, thawing out.
Yeah, you like that?
Mm-hmm. If you love penguins so much, you wouldn't take a private jet, right? Because that's bad for global warming.
No, I'm taking that plane.
Oh, okay, so you don't like penguins. Got it. All right, well, Andre, the NFTs, like I said, coming out July 9th. Four NFTs, a mix of auction items and first come, first serve. So go check it out. And any questions for us? I mean, this has been great. We appreciate you coming on.
Let's do this again.
Yeah? You like this that much? Fuck yes.
Maybe do it in person when you come out here to talk with the Nets.
I almost shook my head for that, too. You almost got me.
Wow. I like it. All right. Well, thanks, man. We really appreciate it.
Cheers, you guys. Thank you.
It's good to meet you, man.
See ya.
Andre Drummond is brought to you by TickPick. TickPick is the original no-fee ticket site that guarantees the best prices on sports and concert tickets. Who's back, Big Cat?
Fans.
Crowds.
Hell yeah.
Crowds are back. And
not
guess
in Tokyo.
Guess what that means? No, not in Tokyo. Mm-hmm. But TickPick, anywhere you can get tickets for something, TickPick is your one-stop shop to get it. I'm just pumped to be doing an ad read for a ticket service again. And this one's even better than some that you may have heard us talk about before, because this is no fees. Fees are the worst part about buying tickets to any sort of live performance. Games, concerts are back, fans in the stands, that's back. And TickPick, no, not Dick Pick, it's TickPick with a T, needs to be your go-to for tickets to live events. TickPick actually invented NFTs when they were the first site to offer no-fee tickets. This has saved fans over $55 million and counting. People accept the bullshit service fees on tickets. I'm just going like from my heart. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say it with my chest. It's bullshit when they charge you fees on a ticket service. It's bullshit. It's absolute bullshit. But TickPick's whole business model eliminated service fees. Don't waste time checking multiple sites to compare ticket prices, because TickPick is the most fan-friendly ticket site there is, because they guarantee the best prices on live event tickets. If you don't believe it, if you can find better prices for the same seats on another ticket site, TickPick will give you 110% of the difference in purchase price. TickPick should be your first choice to buy tickets. I'm going to buy Limp Bizkit tickets using TickPicks. I've made that decision, executive choice in my head. Fred Durst, it's rolling. This summer it's rolling on. I'm going to go see Limp Bizkit. 1998 is back. TickPick is helping us get there. They're saving fans money by never charging any service fees ever. We love TickPick. Visit tickpick.com/take today. Get $10 off your first order on live event tickets. Don't forget to download their app, TickPick. TickPick.com/take. 10% off your first order on live event tickets. And don't forget to download their app.
Okay, we're going to finish up with Fyre Fest of the Week. Just a shout out, by the way, to Jake and Youngstown Bob and PMT Memes, the backup crew that might actually have a full-time job. I don't know. Well, no, they have full-time jobs.
You know who Wally Pipp is, Big Cat?
Yeah.
I'm just asking if you do.
Do you know who Wes Welker is?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
I do know who Wes Welker is.
Exactly. So you guys have been great this week. We appreciate it. All the AWLs appreciate it. So follow PMT Memes. Jake, what's your Twitter account again? You didn't shout it out.
JLisofsky25. Good luck spelling it.
There we go. All right. So I'll just tweet your Twitter out again. And then Youngstown Bob, you all know him. He's fucking just eats pussy from sea to shining sea.
The mustache looks great, by the way.
All right, so PMT Memes, you want to start?
I'm going first.
This might be your Fyre Fest that you have to go first. Jake, why don't you start?
All right, I'll go first. as I mentioned last show, I moved last week, so today I did my first official commute from my new city. And for everyone living in the Northeast, it's tropical storming here.
Yep.
Took a step outside. I just moved. I live on the water, not to brag. And
that is a sick brag.
I had to walk along this like boardwalk thing, and just the wind plus the storm. I came in 7 hours ago. My socks are still absolutely soaked.
Dude, I have extra socks. You want some?
Yeah.
Actually. In the pile. Yeah, I have extra socks.
I'll grab some.
All right. I got like 40 pairs of socks.
I'm in.
Can I give you a little piece of advice moving into a new place? Don't take an Uber when you could take public transportation for at least the first month, because if you do it, you're not going to want to go back.
Yeah,
you'll
true.
Just like find any excuse to be like, oh, I guess it's too late for me to take the train, might as well hop into a cab.
Yeah.
And then you just waste all your money on that.
You though, that was a great Fyre Fest though, because you're basically like, it sucks that I now am like a seafaring, you know, I live on the beach.
I honestly was better off just swimming across the Hudson.
Yeah.
That's how wet I got.
Oh man. Bob. All right. Youngstown Bob. Well, you had too much pussy this week? Is that what your neck hurt?
Drowning.
You got sex addiction? You addicted to sex?
All right. So last week, the New York City Twitter account like just threw a shot at Cleveland. They said a gloomy day in New York City is still better than a sunny day in Cleveland.
Ooh.
And just now there's a tropical storm here, and I've got all my friends just like sending me tweets of like the flooded subways. And
what's the weather in Cleveland like?
It was beautiful last week too. I read the tweet when I was at an outside bar on the lake with a bucket of beer in front of me, live music, And I was torn about it.
But
I love New York City. But
yeah,
like,
I was going to say, but let's try to watch college football on a Saturday in Cleveland.
Uh-huh.
It's tough.
It's not the same. You can't go to a bar that has every single team.
Oh,
I
have the tweet, actually. New York, this is from Youngstown Bob. New York City bars are such a fun place to watch college football. Fans from every school.
Yeah, I was just probably wasted at Bar Coastal. Probably, no, 100% what happened. Yeah.
And everyone on the production side just retweets it every Saturday.
Yeah, Liam is the first one that does it.
It's a great tweet. You know that other cities have that, right?
Oh, yeah, I know.
Okay.
And
right,
also,
but New York City.
It can be annoying as fuck to be in a bar filled with all sorts of college football.
And
fans.
I also would argue that New York City, like, has not the best college football Saturday scene. Like, there aren't a lot. Like, there are, but they're not.
No,
you know what I mean?
We got best bourbon, best barbecue, and best college football in America, New York City.
All right. Memes, you ready?
I'm up.
Yeah,
go for it.
Yeah, is that okay? Or you want to pass again?
Go for it, memes.
Here we go, memes.
My fire fest is Vin Diesel memes. I can't stop saying family, and I was late on the trend.
Oh,
so
no.
So has it passed? Because I'm still not entirely sure what the family means. I've seen you tweet out a few of them. But
yeah,
I feel like once I start using them,
I got in
that's when
them.
You know it's
so
totally
wait,
done.
This is like a huge deal for you because you are the memes guy. We call you memes. And which, by the way, I don't. Connor.
Yes.
Oh, I got it. Yeah. Okay. All right. Whew. I was like, do I know you're, because, you know, once you get a nickname, it just is that nickname. So you're memes.
Yeah. I stopped telling people my actual name.
Yeah. Just go with memes. Memes is way better. But this is a big deal because this is like, you got to be at the start of every meme.
Yep.
So how are you? I think what you do at that point is you just power through it and tweet so many of them. People will be like, hey, memes is the Vin Diesel guy.
Yeah, I tweeted out like three, and then people were, you could tell, they were like, stop.
Oh,
it's too much.
Fuck.
How can you tell if a meme is hot enough for you to start using?
You got to see it starting to trend, but if it's too trendy.
Like right.
If there's like five tweets that have 100,000 likes, you probably miss a boat.
Certain
you
people from ESPN adopter. Have tweeted it, and you're like, ugh.
Yeah, and then they're like, Thanos called Endgame. And
yeah,
then,
Bleacher Report tweets it with the fucking skull emoji. You're like, it's over.
And you're like, it's done.
Okay, wait, is it now?
That's usually when me and PFT pick it up.
Yes. I was saying, like, when we do it, then it's absolutely over.
No, but that's actually when it's the renaissance.
Resurgence. You get the resurgence of it. I was going to say, like, is it cool now to make a meme of like a player turning into Patrick Starr after they do a cool dunk? Or has enough time passed since Bleacher Report tweeted that out?
No, you can bring it back.
You can bring that. We should. Could you work on that for us?
I could try.
I've got another. Do you do memes on request?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've actually asked them to beef up my coffee memes.
Okay, so for Sunday, for England, Italy, I would like to have the queen, what's her name, Elizabeth II, getting out of the limousine at the toll booth in Godfather and then just getting shot up by some Italians.
Ooh, that's pretty good.
All right, I'll work on
it. Also, maybe can you put a little cannoli on the top of the mini car that brings out the ball?
Done.
All right, beautiful.
Okay.
That car is so cool. I fucking love that car.
Yeah, they do that with rugby, too. All the team gets on the field, and then they drive the ball out right to the guy that's about to kick it off.
So cool. Fucking love it. So cute. Good job, memes. Your debut on Pardon My Take. Who would have thought you'd be here, right? Is it a little mind-blowing?
Look at us.
Yeah, is it a little mind-blowing?
He's doing a meme right now.
You spent 2 years tweeting at us?
Yeah.
And doing a great job?
It was 1 year.
One year? There you go.
I just love it. I love it. You think in memes. You have a beautiful mind.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, PFT?
My Fire Fest of the week is that Kurt Warner has a movie coming out, and I'm going to have to watch it. And it looks terrible. But I'm going to have to watch it because
I think we have to all watch
it together. It uses officially licensed NFL products in it and logos. They have the rights, much like in Draft Day, which would have been maybe the worst movie ever made if it didn't have official team logos in it. But since it did, it's awesome. I'm going to have to watch the Kurt Warner story. And it looks like the corniest movie ever. It looks like if he's got
the corniest life ever.
If Air Bud was a person, that's what this movie would be.
Yes. The other thing that I love about football movies, and you saw it in some of the still pictures that they posted out there, is like the actors they hire that are big, but they're not like football players. They're just big dudes.
Yeah.
Like I saw a guy behind him, and you're like,
that guy doesn't look like he lifts weight. He's just fat. Mm-hmm. And so they just throw big dudes on the sideline like, this is a football team.
I honestly think that we could get into movies like that as extras, just on the sideline.
Yeah.
You've got the frame for like being a linebacker.
Yeah.
I've got the frame for like a shitty kicker.
Yeah.
It could. Why haven't we gotten that call
scat
yet?
Back?
Scat back, yeah, like a Danny Woodhead mm-hmm. type.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm confused why we haven't gotten that call yet. But I'm going to have to watch it because it's a movie. It's about football. And Randy Quaid's brother as Dick Vermeil is fucking hilarious.
So good. So good.
It's hilarious. Like the trailer, everyone that I know that's seen it has looked around and been like, is this real? Or are they doing a sketch comedy?
It's going to be great.
It's going
to
be amazing.
I'm ready to watch it. All right, my Fyre Fest, I'll wrap up. So I went on vacation. I realized something this week that my life has completely peaked. It's over. But the small victories are basically all I have left. And it happened when I went on vacation. I took my family to Eastern Long Island. And what?
In Eastern
Long Island. That's actually just a way to say the Hamptons, but not be a fucking douchebag about it. I took them to the eastern point of Long Island. And packing a car with two little kids and like doing the Tetris move to get the whole car full, I've never felt... I earned my dad pinstripes. Like, that was the official moment where I was like, yeah, I'm a dad. Mm-hmm. Because it was the hardest thing I've ever done. And it was like, I wasted not a single inch. And it felt great. I'm still like glowing off of that.
There's no better form of birth control than going through the airport as somebody without children and then watching people with kids trying to get their kids to just do the most basic of things to ensure that they don't lose the flight. I see that. I'm like, I don't think I ever want a child.
I also didn't use PEDs because I went online and I found the racks that you put on top of your car where you can just load it up. I bought one and I started to load it up and I was like, nah, you know what? Fuck this. I can get everything in this fucking car.
Yeah, I thought you were going to say like, go buy a bunch of Benadryl and then the kids are quiet.
No. That may be for the next one.
Yeah.
That absolutely will happen for the next
one. But
good
for you. That's a big feather in your cap.
I'm glowing from it. It's sad. It's pathetic.
Uh-huh.
But let me have my moment. I think other dads who listen to this show will know exactly what I'm talking about. That when you really feel like...
a provider.
Yeah. The man of the house when you're like, all right, I got this car packed. Everyone's in here. Let's hope we don't crash. But if we do crash, let's just hope I die. So mm-hmm. I don't have to deal with like picking up all my shit on the highway.
Right. So back in the day, it was like a caveman that could go out and kill a brontosaurus mm-hmm. and have dinner for the next 3 years for his family. That's the mark of a man. You put two car seats in.
Two car seats and a shitload of stuff. So much fucking. You wouldn't believe how much shit comes with kids.
What do you listen to on road trips with kids?
I was actually just listening to the Grateful Dead. I put on a whole show and I didn't care.
Okay.
Yeah, I wasn't. That's not. We're never going to change that.
Are you doing the Trolls soundtrack?
No, listen. The playing kids music in the car is not going to happen.
The Trolls soundtrack is not kids music.
I'm not.
Cat.
No.
Anna Kendrick,
it's not going to happen.
Singing Get Back Up Again.
Is that
the song of the summer?
The Cup song is on that?
No,
Anna Kendrick.
That's the old. That's like what, Pitch Perfect?
Yeah.
That's When I'm Gone.
I might play. I might play Pitch Perfect.
You will listen to the Trolls song and you'll fall in love with it.
No.
Yep.
No.
Guaranteed. Don't knock it till you've heard it.
No. All right. Let's do numbers. Send everyone off. I think the regular crew's back. You guys have been great. Thank you again.
Give me an 8.
Because the office is closed this week. Did we mention that?
Office closed.
What time is it?
They were within their rights. It's 12:16 a.m. right now.
12:16 a.m. The office is closed, but we're here.
Pick a number, Memes.
32.
32 for Memes. Jake?
42.
Bob?
I was going to do 42. What the fuck?
Oh, wow.
Well, you could double up, Jackie Robinson, guys.
I'll do 52.
Oh, right. Why do you hate Jackie?
52.
Mariano,
okay. Wasn't 8. He a murderer?
No.
No.
Rico told me that.
Really?
A murderer?
Yeah. Rico said that. I don't know. I get all my information from Rico.
Are you thinking about Ugeth Urbina?
No. Rico definitely has told me that Mariano Rivera is a murderer.
I mean,
he said a lot of things.
He said a lot of alleged. Not the part that Rico told me, but the part that he's a murderer.
Okay.
That's alleged. What's your number?
8.
8, 52, 42,
32.
Memes, if you get this, I will. Right now you're on an internship. If you get 32 on your first try, I will do everything I can to get you hired like tomorrow, full time. So that's just
Let's
on.
Go.
The,
okay,
this is on there.
I'm rooting
like,
for 32.
I seriously will. I will walk into Erica's office on Monday and be like, we got to hire this guy. He got 32.
Walk in tomorrow to her office.
Not saying you won't get a job anyway because you've been doing a great job, but I'm saying
We'll make it happen right away. Are you ready for this?
It's a destiny move. All
right, 99.
Move. Yeah.
Now I'm rooting for you, memes.
Come on, 32.
Oh, 69.
Billy.
Oh, Billy. 69.
Get it?
All right, memes, we'll still try to get you a job,
memes,
right?
Do you have a fun fact?
A fun fact.
Yeah, this is usually when Billy gives a fun fact.
Just do it in memes form.
Alligators are ornery because of their medulla oblongatus.
Okay, yeah, that's right. From Waterboy.
Waterboy. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Good meme, good reference. Love you guys.
Felt a pair of tits while I watched Waterboy in the theaters.
Love you guys. Bonk.
It's Pardon My Take, presented by Barstool Sports. Take on me, take on me.